All the germs.
The other day, I was cruising through the woods. It was, just to check some stuff out. We have some different...
Guideline, depending on the size of the structure,
did they?
Two or three.
Oh, McCulkin?
He can have it.
The Conservation Commission meeting is called to order, being 7 o'clock. Tonight's meeting is being recorded for RCTV. It's, you can find it on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. And you can check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. Being 7 o'clock, we are reopening the public hearing for DEP-270-0669, Lot 4 Kylie Drive, Map 34, Lot 143, Dohadwala. Hope I pronounced that correctly. And this is now reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. Commission will receive reports from administrator, any technical advisor. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. And I would strongly encourage anybody who's attending this meeting to sign in the sign-in sheet in the left-hand side of the room. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Tarone, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couillard.
David Pinnett.
Okay. And would the applicant like to... we did receive some new information.
Thank you. Tony Cappuccini, representing the applicant, Hayes Engineering. We were here 2 meetings ago, projecting a single-family house within the buffer zone with associated pool and landscaping. There were some comments from the board as well as the Trails Commission that was here. We tried to incorporate these comments in the latest revised plan. The first comment that came up was the original plan had indicated a wetland flag number 11, RSA 11A. That was a scrivener's error. It should have been labeled 11A. However, Elizabeth Wallace from my office, environmental scientist, met Mr. Tyrone and Ms. Longley walked the line. During that review, some flags were placed. The 13 tree flag uphill was originally placed on a large tree, which was a red maple, I believe, and the flag was moved to include that maple into the wetland line. And then flag number 13A was also placed out in the field, and then the remaining flags connected. That did affect the buffer zones, being the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation, as well as the 10-foot root protection zone off of that. As a result, we revised the building plan to eliminate 6 inches off of the porch with the pool underneath, and overhang the last 3 feet of that porch, which is allowed under the conservation ordinance. No more than 2 feet should approach. We're at 2 feet, 8 inches into the zone overhang. No foundation. Other question that did come up, there was a driveway up at the top that encroached into the trail easement. We removed any paving in the trail easement. And then some of the comments about that trail included, you know, making sure it was inviting for the public to use without close proximity. What we did was we added a kind of decorative retaining wall that's about...
Do you want me to switch to the other plan?
Excuse me?
Do you want me to switch to the other plan?
No, this is okay. Fine. No. The retaining wall located right here, about 18 inches high. But we feel that adds kind of a separation to the driveway and the trail. The trail, if you go out there now, is just kind of a worn path. What we're proposing is to work with the Trail Commission to provide them, you know, up to a 5 foot wide path that's either compacted earth or some sort of non-erodible material to kind of make it look inviting off of the curb, as well as replace the existing sign that's there should it need to be temporarily moved during the work. I don't see that needing to be done, but the sign will remain. They have some markings through the trail. In order to delineate the actual easement, what we're proposing is to go out and put either iron rods or iron pipes so that easement itself will be forever memorialized, so they can be found and maintained by the Trail Commission, and also so the applicant won't be approaching to that trail easement either. And what I'll do is, the other issue is some mitigation for the amount of work that we were proposing. We looked at removing invasive species. There were some invasives out there, buckthorn and bittersweet. Talking to our botanist, she seemed to think that going into the wetlands or the zone natural vegetation to remove that may do more harm than good. So we proposed a buffer of the natural vegetation. I'll let the landscape architect discuss some of the plantings that are proposed. Peter Ferlin from Superior.
Yeah, so we are, the area in green is proposed for all natural plantings. We provide you a list there. Variation of trees, shrubs, grasses, and ferns throughout there. We went past the required area, so went right past the house, brought it up along the this side here, and brought it up along the trail. We have no intention of planting any lawn area here. We just left this area here. This will also be planted. We just would like to leave that a little bit open so we have a little bit a broader plant palette for it to provide just around close to the house. We can maintain the shrubs a little bit better. And again, in here, we're looking for some privacy, but we don't have a lot of space. So again, we just want to have a little bit of flexibility on those plants in that area. But if we had just done the area within the 35 buffer, we would have been at about 2,000 square feet of native planting. And with the area we have outlined that we're at 2,700 square feet native plantings.
Was I supposed to get that in my packet? Or did that just arrive at Town Hall today, or?
This
native planting plan?
The native planting plan didn't go out. It was part of two pages, and only one page was sent out.
Yeah, because I didn't see that in my packet. I'm just wondering where, like, this is new to me tonight, so just trying to figure out that. How many square feet did you say of native planting?
We're at 2,700.
2,700?
Yes.
And is the area all highlighted in green?
In green, yeah.
All right.
So, going back to the trails, you've got a proposed retaining wall to separate the trail from the driveway, and you're willing to put in, did I see 5 feet of crushed stone?
Crushed stone dust.
Okay, and
whatever the Trail Commission feels.
And then iron bounds along the trail and preserving the trailhead sign. And I see that there are members of the Trails Committee. Have you had a chance to review that? And
I'm Will Finch, Trails Committee. I didn't actually review it until now. did discuss it at our meeting previously. We'd like to ask for the crusher run or lint pack type material. It's less likely to roll. I think it packs better. Our associates think probably 12 inches thick if you do that. And then the other point is the bounds for the easement. I would request concrete bounds, turning points. They don't need to stick up very far. But it's more of a more permanent marker than iron or steel.
Are you amenable to that?
Concrete bounds, if they were set, enough that they're not going to damage a lawnmower. An inch or two. The reason why we propose iron rods or iron pipes, there was some thought behind it. This area isn't going to be mowed per se, and it's going to go across the lot through the wetland for the delineation. It's a lot easier to go out with the metal detector and find the pipes after they've been there for a while versus finding a concrete bound. But the trail committee would prefer a concrete bound.
I would leave it up to the Conservation Commission. You seem to have a normal policy of requesting concrete bounds for
wetlands. Right, 25-foot.
25.
That's just my request.
I think these bounds, especially because it's a special trail easement, I think it would help immensely all parties if it was specifically called out and not just a metal stick. I think you can put a metal rod inside the concrete post as well, to
what
make it also.
What about the concrete post that have the rebar in them? It's just,
if you wanted
they
to.
They don't fit as well as with metal. But again, we're willing to work with the trail
commission. Okay. Dave, you have a question?
Yeah, I have a question on the boundary, the delineation of the trail as it's coming up out of the wetland area. You're showing a set of stairs there, and I was just wondering, just structurally, visually, what you're going to have as a, a delineation or a separation as you're coming up that trail. So, someone's walking up that trail is not going to be coming up those stairs and then entering into the driveway.
There'll be a cheek wall that runs with the retaining wall along those steps. It's going to go back to a landscape area.
We plan on trying to minimize that by doing plantings to separate that. We haven't gotten there right there. We do know that's an issue. We don't want them going, but we do want the homeowner to be able to come around the house. So
I get that coming this way, but going the other way, it might be.
We do need to address that through the planting. That's why we didn't sign it to the mitigation, just so that if we need to put something there that's not native, we would like to be able to do that.
I mean, I don't know whether that's going to, extend there and there's going to be a gate or what, but, just...
A sign that just kind of points trail with the right arrow.
But you do have if you get the stone dust over to the right, then that would kind of make it obvious anyway. I'm just, again...
Yeah,
looking at it from not coming from the street down, coming from the woods up.
Right.
One other thing I find on this plan, you have a previous edge of BVW that's in a light gray, and I could see where the old 13 flag was, and that was on that large tree, and then it was moved back to a smaller, it was onto a sapling, and you've got the wetland flag, number 13 reflag, but if you go to the right of the plan, that edge keeps going, and that doesn't seem like it was, correct. Do you see? Yeah, I can see it there. Is that the old plan?
The old plan had 13 going directly to 17.
Okay, all right.
And then there was a 13A that was in the field that I was told was discussed that was supposed to go from 13 to 13A.
Yep, okay. It just was a little confusing from the last time I was out there. But I understand it now. Okay, thank you.
Could I just have a quick question about, I think it's the contours. I just wanted to get an idea of what the actual elevation. Doug, do you mind going back?
Oh, sorry, sure.
Chuck. In the back there, so you've got the 35 no build, you've got the limits of the overhang and the 25 edge. In between there, there's looks like two contours.
Yes, so that would be your 198 and your 196 contour.
Okay.
And there would be no access from the building, with the exception of there are stairs built into the deck and then coming around this way, which is the reason why we included the stairs at the edge of the driveway, was to provide access to the outside. You're going to be down at 198, so it would be just a walkout basement to be a bulkhead.
So, Tony, what is that extra on the garage? Is this an extra parking bay?
On the garage?
Right there, yeah.
Yeah, so this is a one-stall garage, and then there's
so there'll be a garage door in the front of that?
This garage door here. And
it's two garages.
So what would be the big... would it make sense to take that small set of stairs and put it on the back of the garage, so you'd enter the backyard through the garage instead of have them sticking out on the side there into the easement and worried about having to block them off with shrubs?
Just put the door right here, and then put some steps coming out through the garage so you walk out.
It's pretty steep.
Steps. It's
going to be a high set of stairs.
Oh, you probably
want
to
so.
The back of the garage rather than off the side.
Entertain that.
That might solve a handful of problems, I think.
Yeah, I think we could, you know, if that's something the board was looking for.
Strong there.
Well, it gets us out of the easement.
The
yeah, cleans
stairs.
Up that retaining wall. You could just, you know, run that, slope that down into grade. Mm. And then you don't have to worry about what Dave's worried about, anybody coming up, going up those stairs. If those stairs are in the back of that, they're clearly, you know, going into a building. No one's going to walk up there from the trails. And it gets them access to the backyard. You just pop through the garage.
If the commission was open to that,
I don't know whatever, if anybody else thinks that's a good idea.
I don't think it's a bad idea. What do the members think?
Yeah, you know, I think it's an interesting note that you know, the driveway is within the easement.
Well, the easement's, is the, correct me if I'm wrong, the easement's going to be moving.
Oh, that's
now.
Not, oh.
So this will be the new easement.
Then wait, what's
shifting.
This? What's this?
That was the... previous.
This is the drainage easement.
Help me understand.
The
oh, that's
drainage.
The drainage
that's
easement.
The drainage easement.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Not the trail easement.
The trail easement runs at the base of
gotcha.
The retaining wall. So we kept the retaining wall
gotcha.
And stairs outside of the easement.
Right.
But it is tight. And I agree. You know, that suggestion is one that we do.
Okay.
Yeah, so we wouldn't preclude you from walking there anyway. Without the stairs.
According to the plan, it looks like there's only one 3-inch tree that would probably be cut down to develop this lot. Is that accurate? Or are there more trees out there that would probably get cut down?
There, of significance, there is the street tree.
Yep.
And then there's a large kind of crab apple, I believe.
Yeah.
Right in the center of the lot. But beyond that, most of the lot is just brush. There's some smaller pines scattered through, but nothing significant.
Mm-hmm.
Did you plus the roadway tree?
Did you go out?
It's been a while. I've been out, but it's
okay.
It's been a while.
Yeah, it wasn't real robust out there.
I have on my notes that there was some discussion at the last meeting that we're going to talk to an engineer about the grading over that drain pipe. was any of that discussed with an engineer? Town engineering or an engineer on your end? The adding of fill over that drain pipe?
We've
in the
revised the grading that basically all we're doing is kind of modifying this by a few inches just to kind of provide a smooth drainage towards the pond where it's supposed to go. We're not modifying any of it up. You know, there'll be plenty of cover over the pipe. We're an engineering firm. I did not contact the town engineer. Worst case scenario is we could leave the grades exactly as they are. We just kind of showed to indicate the intent is that that should keep pitching towards the pond.
I'm not sure what fill over a drainage pipe has to do with conservation.
Well, it affects the drainage. No, I mean,
well, the slope
like
of it, yeah. If it's going to be like a 3-1 or something.
Eroding or...
It sounds like it's just going to be inches, right, Tom?
Yeah, and that's... Yeah. And again, that was why we proposed some sort of material for the path that Whitman Road. And again, I think we would look to work with the Trail Commission that if they want checks to stop, you know, a lot of times we'll see well on the trail, like a railroad type check. So if it does stop to a road, it hits that check.
So just to be clear, Tony, you guys are okay with the Trails Committee is asking for 12 inches of material on that trail?
That,
you guys okay with that?
That's fine. And
okay.
We'd actually like to, if their concern is vegetation going to the trail, putting a foot establishment in the place.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think that's the right way to do it. And that's
good.
Mm-hmm. And I know that from the letter that you folks sent accompanying this, that you have talked to the, I guess, the engineer regarding lot coverage. So that has been...
Yes, we talked to the building inspector.
Yep. Okay.
I just have one other question. There's granite bounds out there right now. Is that correct?
For the marking the 25 inch?
You're marking, yes.
Yeah.
So, part of this is going to be...
Them,
what's that?
I don't remember seeing them, though. Did you guys see him?
I didn't.
I don't remember.
There's like three, maybe?
Yeah.
More.
There's...
There's not a ton of them. I originally thought the first one I saw was marking the easement.
Oh, that's right. I did see one over by the easement over there. Yeah, you're right. I saw one.
And
I remember.
We imagine that that'd be a standard condition to relocate.
Perfect. That's all I just wanted.
Great.
Great.
Any other questions from the commission?
I have just one comment. The homeowner just said... he just further thought about putting the stairs on the back of the house. And the point for these stairs is just to have some maintenance if people are coming to it. And if this access it through the garage, it kind of doesn't work for him.
You don't want to have maintenance people coming through my garage, right? You wouldn't want to have a maintenance person going through your garage, your vehicles or such, right? That's the issue for that.
Yeah, I don't. That's a personal preference, I guess.
Yeah.
I don't. Wouldn't necessarily bother me, I don't think, but if it bothers you, that's your prerogative.
Yeah. Just to keep that, you know, that the access point around the building.
Then if you're,
or
if
exterior
you're,
to
if
the
you're
building.
If you're stuck on that, then do we have an answer for addressing separating those stairs from the trail?
Yeah.
Well, I think he's outside
it
of
is.
The easement.
Outside the easement, right?
It's outside the easement, but we're talking about the possibility, what Dave brought up was the possibility of somebody roaming up those stairs coming from the trail, not knowing exactly where the easement is or isn't.
But then also, if you do that, if you have those stairs there, you're also going to be changing the grade that you're showing there. You know, you got four stairs showing there, four stairs showing there, so you're not coming, I think you're coming down, that's going to be a different gradient between the trail and those stairs. And the cheek of those stairs. So
there's six steps at 8 inches would be 4 feet.
Right.
And you're at about 205.
The garage floor is 209.
Yeah. Right there. So.
Would it make any sense to extend that retaining wall, maybe to run along those stairs and a little farther past those stairs to for a little further separation?
Yeah, we could even pull the first step. Extend this maybe 6 or 8 inches back here and then extend the wall.
Bring the wall down to kind of separate the two?
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you guess?
I think it's fine.
Fine with me.
I had a question about the southwest corner of the wall. Could you just sort of describe, like, when this project is finished as proposed, what the if I'm standing kind of in the wetland buffer area and I'm looking at the back of the house, from like left to right, what am I seeing? You know what I mean? So like.
So down this area, stating
wall.
Yeah, yeah.
There's an existing stone retaining wall slope that we're going to tie into with the proposed retaining wall for the project, which I think is a fieldstone.
Yes.
Finish. So it would be a fieldstone drywall placed
yep.
up against it. That would extend with the deck over it here, tying back into the house this way. So you would see fieldstone along here. Then.
Okay, can you hold on just a sec? So I thought there was a wall above that fieldstone wall that was about 10 feet high around the pool.
I'm sorry.
So
above the
I'm confused.
The, above the fieldstone wall here, the wall's at 2065. There's a fence, like a decorative wrought iron and black
yeah.
metal fence. To just so that there's, from standing in the yard, there's going to be at least a 6-foot fence around the pool. That ties into the deck and ends at the deck. Then the fieldstone wall continues below the deck and comes back in. This will probably be more of the foundation base. Then the back of the house would be poured foundation and then strapped and finished down to the side, so it would look like the back of a house.
Okay, so just to be clear, the area between, so this is where I'm confused, so help me out. So it looks like the fieldstone wall, it almost looks like a shape, almost like a lightning bolt.
Yes, yeah, so
the little top. Zigzag there, the gray shaded
yes.
with the dashed line.
And
however, south of that is the proposed retaining wall around the pool, and on the previous plans, the top of that retaining wall was 10 feet higher than the bottom of the retaining wall. So is the fieldstone wall under that? Is the fieldstone wall on top of that 10-foot retaining wall?
The top
wall?
Of the retaining
that
wall is 206.5.
Yep, and the
bottom, and the bottom
is 198. So it's going to be an 8-foot high.
10, 8-foot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fieldstone wall. And it's an engineered type wall. It's kind of like a fieldstone's kind of
prefab
panel.
Sections.
All right.
You can provide a cut sheet. Yeah.
Did you already provide like wall cross sections for those or?
We did not. The engineering for the wall usually comes after. The company
yeah.
that provides it will.
And that's typically provided to the building department, isn't that right?
Yeah.
As part of the permitting process.
But
so it's not.
It's not going to be
a
concrete wall. It's going to be a decorative wall that looks like a hand placed fieldstone wall, but it'll
yeah.
be
and then through the mitigation plan, very much soften that wall. You know.
Yeah. So it's going to be kind of sloped backward versus being like a vertical
it's
wall?
It's a fairly vertical.
There's a batter on it about, I think it's only a quarter inch per foot.
Yeah. So
just a little bit.
Yeah.
A little tiny.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Any questions from the community?
I just have a couple questions. Do we have a quantity on the ferns and trees and shrubs that are going in the restaurant?
I just have a square footage. I mean, if you told me the spacing you want on things, I'd more than willing to do that.
All right, so I can just work with you and
yeah.
get out on
yeah.
to get a quantity. And then with these changes, we need a new set of plans. Represent the changes, and the two trees are moved. One of the trees is a street tree. Did you talk to Bob Keating about replacing that? Is that something you expect to do?
That's, we expected to either be able to move the tree because it's not very significant right now, or just replace it.
Okay, and the tree in the back. We have a tree, shade tree policy, and you need to replace that tree that you're cutting in the back.
I thought there were two trees.
Well,
one is a street tree outside of the 100-foot.
Okay, but isn't there one in the middle as shown and then an apple tree as well?
That's
no,
the one.
That's
oh,
the
that
one.
Is the apple. Oh.
So you need to either plant a tree, 3-inch caliper, or you have an option to just donate to the town under the shade tree policy. So one of those, we're going to need to know what you're going to do about that.
Would any of the native plantings suffice for that?
Yeah, exactly.
Sounds like
and
a
so
lot
if
of
we
them.
Identified at least three-foot-tall native plants, okay. you could use that to remove the tree.
Okay.
I think previously we asked for an O&M plan too.
I think it was included in the original submittal.
I don't know if it was
for O&M for what.
I don't know, maintenance of the buffer, or I'm not sure the
I thought you meant the coal tech.
Yeah, maybe the coal tech.
I remember getting an O&M plan for.
It was mentioned during the last meeting. It's just one of my.
For the
call tech. Yeah,
the
right.
Drain.
Yep, for the
call tech. There was something submitted with the original.
Okay, there's maintenance table.
So we are waiting for a new plan, or what are we looking for?
What exactly is the new plan going to show? The movement of the stairs and the wall?
No, they're not moving they're making a small adjustment to the stairs and extension of the wall.
I think, so can we approve this contingent upon them getting this to Chuck before we sign it?
So just sorry to continue in line with Anika's. Did we ever get calculations for the coal tech?
I thought I'm seeing those on the left hand side of the plan, but I can't be sure. But that might have been, no, you know what, that was the square footage.
That's the impervious area?
Yeah. Impervious.
Yeah.
Mm.
Okay. All right. So basically gives you the rooftop area.
You get a little bit.
And we designed it for a half an inch. Required 104 cubic feet of storage. Each chamber holds 64 cubic feet, so we provided two of them, or 128, almost 129 cubic feet, so we're in excess of the half inch.
So there are two Cultecs?
Yes, there's one in the front and one in the rear. The one in the rear.
Oh, okay. Yep. Yep.
And then there's one up in the front to split the house. It's kind of a pain.
Yep.
Well, I would love to see a copy of the of the planting plan. Look that over.
I think Chuck said that he was going to work it out with the landscape architect.
Well, there's also going to be some additional plantings along the easement, right? For privacy and the like.
But those are just optional for the homeowner. He's just going to do that for himself to try and work out those stairs. But I think with the modification of the stairs and extending that wall a little bit, it would probably be less necessary to put a bunch of planting over there.
Plus part of the plantings actually went up that side anyway.
Chuck, do you have this prepared?
No.
For tonight?
No.
So,
no.
I mean, I'm just talking time here. What does it matter if it's still going to have to be signed at the next meeting?
So we can't close the meeting. Close it.
So approve it subject to a satisfactory planning.
Yeah. I make a motion to approve.
Well, let's make sure Chuck has all the right notes. You've got 12 stone bounds. Is that what's on this plan? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12?
Motion.
And you get the notes on the 1 foot of the gravel and 5 feet wide with the filter app?
All that's going to be on the plan.
It's going to be on. Oh, he's going to put that. You're going to put that in the plan, Tom?
Yeah, modify the plan.
Okay.
So I guess I would propose. I make a motion to continue, and Chuck, I would just ask that you've got a list of things, they're gonna get us some things that.
And then it can be, then it can be ready for the next meeting, prove it and sign it.
Yep.
You'll be on your way. That's, I'll second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much.
The, our next meeting, we're gonna decide whether we're gonna have a second meeting in November right now, so, or at least at the end of this meeting. Sure.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
I appreciate that.
Okay. It's past 7:10, so we are going to, as a public hearing for notice of intent 270-0673 Randall Road Extension, map 10, 15 lots 294 and 296 and 5678 Hall is being now being reopened and conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. And the continuation will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present things that we discussed at the last meeting. Commission will receive reports from its administrator, and the commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which you should be directed to the chair. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the commission, starting on my right.
David Pinnett.
Al Couliard.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Michael Flynn. Chuck Tirone, Conservation Administrator.
And Jack McCulkin.
Jack McCulkin, Registered Engineer for JM Associates. Mark Hall couldn't be here tonight. He's ill.
Thank you. So late. I have the pleasure of doing it myself.
Thank you.
This is a revised existing conditions plan that I think the board had asked for to put the displaced wetlands on the plan. It also upgraded the trees within the buffer zone to include the non-invasive.
I think you meant invasives.
Invasives,
yeah.
That is what I meant.
Last one,
so this is existing conditions. Do you want me to switch to the how the proposed houses, trees, drainage? We're gonna just start. It's up to you, Jack.
Well, I've got the landscape.
Okay. Yeah, let's put that out there right now.
So this is a landscape plan that the board had for last time, showing the replacement trees, and then Chuck had asked us to plot on here as well the trees that were being displaced. So we're displacing 40 trees, including the invasives, and we're replacing the 40 trees with 35 trees and also 15 shrubs within the wetland replication area. And at the 3-to-1 ratio, that would work out to the 40 trees.
And I did verify that this afternoon with Jack, that he's met the replacement policy within the buffer zone.
Okay.
So, and we were out there earlier this week, but so anything that's a black dot here is a tree that's going to be taken out. It's not just the trees that you've logged, but these are the actual trees that will be removed.
That's correct.
Correct. And I noticed when we were out there, we didn't have this at the time, but each one of these is actually flagged and numbered out there. Is that, I think you did seem like you did a pretty good job of actually flagging.
Yes.
We noticed, I do believe it is in lot 2, towards the back of the deck, maybe 10 to 15 feet towards the wetland or to the north, that there was a very large oak tree that had some significant limb fall off. One was in the deck area. Are you proposing to take that down?
I wish Mark was here to discuss it, but I guess not at this time. We didn't. We assumed that any trees, that oak tree, I know which one you're talking about, is actually in the zone of natural vegetation. So we weren't proposing to take any of those trees down. Now, after seeing that one, we may have to revisit it.
We had some discussion at the site visit, and we were thinking, the reason that we came up with a tree replacement policy with trees and shrubs is because we have an awful lot of, single-family homeowners coming in and saying that they are concerned about stiff winds and these close trees falling on their property. And I think, given the location of that house, I think that would be, a significant danger tree to the house. You can see that there's a lot of damage currently to the limbs of that tree, and it is leaning towards the deck. The other thing that Chuck and I were discussing is there's like a gully in back of that deck. Did you think that the deck, where the staking was located, was not quite right?
Well, so what it appears in both lot 2 and lot 3, it seems like there's not a lot of space, obviously, beyond the 35 no structure zone. But not just that, there's a, off the corner, in particular lot 2, there's a gully that drops off. It wasn't clear to us if there was any proposed grading in that area or what exactly was going to occur. It seems like it's a pretty big drop right off the back there.
Yeah, it's can you bring up that grading?
Yeah.
Sure. It's a little hard to see at this point scale.
There's
like a 254 contour that keeps moving around.
Yeah, you're going to have to hold on a second. Does that work?
Yes. Yeah, so there's like a, I noticed it almost looks like a ramp that goes in through here and around. And it gets up to 254, drops down to 252, drops down to 250, actually on either side. And, it is a little hard to see on the 40 scale, but the proposed grading is to basically grade down to the elevation 252. This would be a walkout basement at 252. And we would be basically meeting the existing grade back here. I mean, the idea is that ramp is going to actually be cut down because it's going to be basically in the basement a lot too.
So that deck's going to be 8 feet in the air?
I think that's actually going to be a at-grade deck or a patio.
Oh.
So, okay.
So that's on the ground. That's
That's at the walkout.
Yeah, it's a walkout, yeah. They're both walkouts. This deck, I think, is probably going to be in the air.
Okay.
Probably going to be a walkout off the first floor.
That makes sense. That's why I was so hung up on the walkout basement with the deck. Okay.
Will there be any, on lot three, will there be any exit points on the back side of the home?
I'm sure there'll be a walkout door somewhere along here.
That would be a little bit different than, so yeah, so you're saying this deck would actually probably be on
this deck? I think this deck will be up on the first floor.
Okay. And so there would be a walkout to the back. I think we brought this up at the last meeting, but you know, one of my concerns is the, what's that look like as they walk out? You know, they're going to be walking out onto
grass.
You know, it is right on the no, basically right on the no structure zone. There's not a lot of room, but one of the concerns is, you know, homeowner's going to get in, and the first thing they're going to say is, "Why don't I have a patio back here? Why don't I have something?"
Or at least
some sort of landing.
A concrete pad to step out on, so you're not going from mud to house.
Right.
It looks like they have enough room for that.
Yeah.
Yeah. They just don't have, like, you know, they couldn't put a 20 by 20 patio out there or anything, but it looks like there's enough room for a 4 foot by 8 foot pad to walk out a slider.
Yeah. I just want to make sure, if that's something that would be proposed, I just want to make sure it's something we get on now. Just so we know where it is, we know where it is relative to the 35 foot.
It's easier now to move that slider to the wider area in advance right now than put it on the house and be stuck.
Think about it now, because we know where this line is. We know where it deviates away.
No, you're right.
I know one of the things that we discussed the last meeting that DEP brought up was cross-section for the wetlands replication area. Do we know where the groundwater is in the replication area? Have you done any pits?
Yeah, we did a test pit right at this location right here. And I believe the groundwater, I think, look that up, I believe it's around elevation, I'm going to say 248.
I remember being right about at the bottom of the swale, right?
Right.
Well, this says bottom of replication is 249.5, so it's be a foot and a half above the water table. Is that right? Am I reading that right?
No, the swale right here. So, but this doesn't have the grade, the elevations on it.
Well, but the question was, what's the water table in the replication area?
He's saying it's 248.
Yeah, so the bottom of the replication area is a foot and a half above that, then.
Yeah, it's like bottom elevation is 249.5.
Wouldn't we rather have the bottom of that replication area at 248?
Within a foot, within 12 inches.
I think we discussed at the last meeting that the bottom of the replication area pretty much is at the water table.
That's not what he's saying now.
We did talk about that.
Although we've got some seasonal low right now. So.
Right, it's been pretty dry.
Yeah. So I, with an understanding that the purpose of that first forebay was supposed to stay wet.
The water quality swale is wet.
Right. So
that's the longer one.
The longer one, right?
Right. Okay.
Oh, okay.
This one.
All right. Gotcha.
Yep.
I wonder why, and I'll ask Chuck. How many times has the board approved a constructed wetland instead of a detention, a replication area? Recently.
A constructed wetland instead of a replication.
Yeah, area? I think a lot of communities are building constructed wetlands as opposed to replication areas to eventually just fill them themselves and become a wetland with the same type forebay. Jack probably knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah, constructed like a pocket wetland.
Yeah. And it flows, shapes the water. Mike, you've seen these, right? You probably designed them.
I
haven't designed them.
Okay.
I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it flows the flow of the wetlands through an area like a snake to an outfall, almost like a replication area, but it's bound and planted in all certain areas with native species, and then eventually it grows in. Just because it's a better looking, longer lasting alternative to just a flat bottom replication area.
Yeah, we've done a couple of them.
Yeah, I've done a couple myself. That's how I know it's preferred in a lot of communities.
So that replication area is between a existing wetland and the water quality swale.
Mm-hmm.
And it's giving us a 2-to-1 for the isolated wetlands that are being taken out. So I don't know where you would put it.
I don't know,
it.
Yeah. The serpentine water course.
This is also the outflow from the retention basin.
Right.
And the storm drains.
Yep. That's
it's all
fine.
Flowing out here.
Yeah.
And then it goes into the long
one. Through here, goes around and in here.
Yeah.
So what
I know.
Can you explain?
Yeah, it would come out the
forebay, yeah,
and then come out here and then snake through this, and then it would make a couple turns in here and be mounded up and planted and stoned, and then you know at a certain level it would exit.
Jack, do you need that water quality swale to get your 80%? So what you're trying to redesign is needed in his treatment train for stormwater and MS4. So we have
you're not
higher
saying get
standards.
Rid of the swale.
I'm not saying get rid of the swale.
What's that?
I'm not saying get rid of the swale. I'm saying redesign the bottom of the detention area to a constructed wetland instead of
a replication
area.
All right, so we have a swale, we have a replication area. And
so,
then we have
so
a
four-bay swale.
Wait a minute, and then we have a detention area right there. So what are you talking about? I just need you to say
which
we
one
have.
Are you talking about?
I'm talking about the one in lot two.
The one in
the
lot.
Replication area in lot two. Sure.
The replication area. That the purpose
this,
of that replication area is to just give us, because the isolated wetland is being taken out. So that's just to return wetlands at a 2-to-1 ratio. It's not for water quality. It's not for it's to replace the wetlands that's being taken out.
Yeah, that's what a constructed wetland is for. The same thing. It's just a modified version of this. That like I said, some communities are turning to because they take better.
That's true, but we're getting that anyways.
What's the difference between what you're suggesting as a constructed wetland and the replication area here?
Some people would argue that a constructed wetland takes better. We want this to be a wetlands.
Because the bottom is going to be contoured?
Because the bottom is contoured and waved, and it has a variation of plants. And the way it winds through it, it distributes the water more evenly.
So is it mounded in small places? Is that
what
you're talking about?
Yeah, it's mounded in a snake-like configuration. I mean, it's just, I'm not saying we have to do it on this. I was just more or less asking.
I mean, it's an interesting concept, but is there...
I haven't seen one in Reading, but I see them all around us.
Would that work in this instance?
Well, I mean, we use it, like Al had said, about for water quality. It could, well, I don't know if it would work in this instance, because we really have to be down at this same elevation as this wetland. Whereas the pocket wetlands at different elevations, and like you said, kind of snakes through.
Right.
So the water quality swale for me gives me my helps my 80% removal, and then the replication is basically to make up for the displaced wetlands. So kind of in this case, it's really two different purposes.
I know when George was here, George for some reason wasn't interested in the constructed wetland. He just wanted a more or less flat replication area or detention pond. I know a couple were brought to him that he said he wasn't interested in, so I think that's why Redding's gone down this path of not using them. But like I said, I see other, it's something we should maybe look at in the future, because I see a lot of other communities using them, and I've seen them 5 or 6 years after they come in, and they generally look a lot better than what's going to happen here.
Okay.
I'm
done.
Is that okay, jumping in? I had a question about the stormwater calc and the stormwater modeling. I guess my my basic question, just to start off, is the storm frequency and the number of inches that were modeled for storm frequency. What data set was used to get that storm frequency?
That was given to us by the town engineer.
Those numbers?
Yeah, the inches and the storms.
I didn't know that. Okay.
I have another question for you on the stormwater management plan, and I kind of went through and kind of put on. I didn't have the sub drainage areas, but I have those now. I'm a little. Is there anything from Randall Road that is contributing, or is there a catch basin that it goes off to the north?
There's two existing catch basins here.
Right.
That takes, kind of a flow from Springvale Road, and then it hits Randall Road, the existing circle, and it goes down into these two catch basins.
Okay.
And
do you know where those catch basins drain to?
Yeah, there's a 24-inch concrete culvert.
Okay.
That goes that way, and it actually hooks up to this ditch, I think, further down.
Okay.
I mean, hooks up to the swale going in the back along the back of the property.
Yeah, that swale. I think at some point here, it like makes a right turn.
It's just a flat end there. It just dumps out there.
Honestly, I haven't walked back this far, but I think it probably is a flat end, and up it goes on that ditch.
I don't know if it's flat. I don't speak your language. It's a big pipe, and it does go exactly the way you described it.
So it goes through your property, Mr. Dunner?
Not mine. Two houses down.
Okay.
Can I follow up on two things from the last time we discussed this? These plans were going into engineering for review, especially the water quality swale and that. Do you know the status of that?
Ryan signed off on this plan.
He did? Okay. And there was another question about some discussion the applicant was having with DPW and their ability to maintain the structures.
Yeah.
Is there any follow-up on that discussion?
I did meet with the town engineer. We went through the O&M manual, and he did agree that they would maintain it.
Okay.
So we're going to need, and I told Ryan this, but I wasn't able to talk to Bob. So it looks like Ryan will do some of the work, but Bob Keating is going to also do some of the work. So we would need something from both, an email, and I can work on that too. But I just want to like put it out there.
So Chuck, that is the maintenance that they're going to take on.
So when I looked into the maintenance, it was so the trees have to be alive and they have to be checked out. There's a list, and it's part of getting the phosphorus out and getting your 80%. So it always has to be part of it. So the homeowners can't touch the trees, but they want someone to water the trees. So that seems to be one of the problems. And then if new trees need to be planted, you have to contact the company. Isn't that true?
I don't think so.
No?
I don't know. I think any landscaper can do it.
Okay.
And they do provide a year of maintenance.
Right, and we were asking, did you check in to see if you could get 2 years of maintenance?
You can get, you can get as many years as you want.
Okay.
Many years as you want to pay for.
Yeah.
So the reason why 2 years is important is because when the town accepts the road, there would be no responsibility put on any homeowner It will just be the contractor and then the town.
So the town would trim those trees or shrubs in accordance to Filterra specs, specifications?
I read the operation maintenance plan said don't trim them or don't have your landscaper trim them.
Well, don't have your landscaper trim them.
I don't know if you know, Bob or the Filterra company would trim them if needed. So it seems like trimming could happen. They just didn't want someone to touch it. I think that is.
I understand that.
Professionals only.
And we don't want them fertilized because the purpose of those is phosphorus removal. So.
So, and the maintenance was twice a year?
Yes.
And so it's remove the silt and put new mulch in?
New mulch once a year.
New mulch.
Okay.
In the foreday?
No, in the
Well, it's kind of like a, it's kind of like a square box with a drain at the bottom, and then it has mulch, and on top of the mulch you would collect the silt. So get the silt out, get the mulch out, and then if it clogs, and I don't know how often that happens, but they probably thought of that. You'd have to take everything out, and you'd have to lift up the grates, which open up like two cabinet doors.
Mm-hmm.
They're like 200 pounds each, and then just take everything apart and get it to work. So that means more monitoring. So, and the reason why the town, you know, this is a big step up for the kind of maintenance that they usually do. But the new MS4 requirements need them to take on this phosphorus removal. And right now, according to Ryan and Jack, this is the only product that works in this location that's available.
Okay. And I think Ryan thought this was actually a good, you know, kind of a small project where it would be a good place to start.
So we have more information that we need, so we can't close this, correct?
No.
I would like to have time to review the tree plan, the existing conditions,
mm-hmm.
and
right.
see what's being removed out there.
There might be some comments from.
Yeah. Okay.
And then, do you want to put the oak tree on there?
Yeah, we need to know. So you've changed the deck on lot 2 to be at ground level, so we need a new plan showing that.
Well, we didn't really, I guess we never really specified, you know, at what level.
You guys got to have to make a decision. It's either going to be the deck or the lot, or you're going to have to come back when you make a decision and come back in front of the commission.
Okay. It's going to be at ground level, so we'll make that clear.
I don't think it's a... I mean, I don't, personally, it doesn't matter to me what they do there. I don't think I'd think it was a big, really minor plan change if it did come in.
I think it's better at ground level because you have something to walk out to from your back door.
Yeah. And then we need those letters from Ryan and Bob Keating, and that's really what we're looking for.
Well, we got to make a decision on that oak tree, right?
And the tree.
Not to obsess about a tree.
So if we decide to take it down, we'd have to add another replacement?
Yes.
We have to add another tree. So what I was told by Jack today is that everything from the silt fence out is being removed. So we're taking all this down. So I didn't know if the commission wanted to kind of look at the plan and understand that there are no trees going to be left, and all the trees going back in are brand new. And to think if that makes sense or not, or are there any trees that could be saved?
So we've got the plan now with the existing locations. We've got the idea, everything inside. I think that gives us an opportunity to take a look at what's out there,
yeah.
and see what makes sense.
That's what kind of an idea. I took a pretty hard look, substantial look, at all the trees that were out there. And I didn't see anything that I said, wow, that really should be saved. I didn't see anything. in the entire project.
Okay,
so I think
it matches up with the plans that we had here, the locations and everything.
Mm-hmm. So it's
even the saplings, the smaller trees,
because
those
would
be the ones that would be the most likely to survive if they were transplanted.
Some of the saplings, though, they're in clumps.
Didn't like
the
holly trees.
I did. I know. I don't think that was.
Some of them in groups.
Oh.
Once you take the competition trees that are around them down, they don't have much to hold them up.
Yeah,
I saw a couple of black cherries that were out there that weren't that bad, but they weren't that great either.
So black cherries invasive, Norway maple invasive, 22 invasive trees, 15 deciduous trees that are native.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't remember the breakdown of those. So we're really talking about, based on our past policy, we're talking about 15 trees. And where do those fall?
Can I bring up another question? I guess then that is, we were out there this week and we went to a site visit, and you know, the density of trees out there, at least maybe because all the leaves are down, but the density, the spacing of trees seems pretty sparse, even though there's a lot of dots on the plan. You know, not a lot of trees with low hanging branches and all that sort of stuff. I guess I'm sort of wondering, when this project is all said and done and finished, what's the area of the 25-foot vegetated zone, what's that going to look like? Is that just going to look like it does today? You know, just a pile of leaves and a couple sparse shrubs along the top of the bank. You know, I just sort of raise it as a...
I don't think was it your intention? You weren't doing anything back in that 25.
No.
You weren't going to touch it, right?
Right.
No,
our
disturb.
Idea was to put the post and rail fence along the perimeter.
At
on,
the 25?
At the 25.
Post and rail. So it could, might fill in.
Well, I think what you're going to find is it's so shady today, there's not much light getting in there.
Well, once it's developed and
that's
opened
the
up,
rail.
It's
going to,
there might be some opportunity.
You're
going to
see all kinds of things sprout in there. Yeah.
But are we going to ask for any plantings in the 25 or to encourage that development, like a shrub or two?
I think that...
It's just a question.
Yeah.
I just throw it out while we have the opportunity to
not much out
it.
There right now for lawn.
No.
I think we've had some projects go in really close, and just remember this when you're trying to figure out what's going on. As soon as the new person comes in, they start extending their lawn out towards
right.
the back. So I like the fence, and
yeah,
you know,
the fence helps. The
fence helps to stop
yeah.
that. Are you proposing
yeah.
any gates back there?
No.
Good. No gates.
Well, you know, that 25-foot zone might it could potentially become like a, you know, a leaf pile dump. Yeah.
That's why there's no gates.
That's why
there's
no gates.
Like no gates.
Well,
so that just, yeah, and then we got to put the markers for the conservation.
Right, that would be the order.
Right
condition.
On the fence. Is it a wood fence, do you think, or vinyl fence?
It
probably doesn't matter to us, but if we can put the markers right on the fence.
No, that fence isn't permanent. I in this
bounds.
Situation with it being so close, I would still use the granite bounds.
Okay, yeah.
Because
that's
going to be a permanent marker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you do that, you put the fence. You know, I think there's a fine line when you start saying, well, you know, we don't want you to build a house because of what a homeowner might do three purchases
no,
later.
No, yeah.
You
no,
know,
I'm
I mean,
not
that's
saying that.
We talked about
up.
It last time. I think I was worried about the deck and the pad on the back on lot three. Just make it easy to get out there. But, you know, we've got to be cognizant of not creating a situation where it's really inviting to build a giant leaf pile or throw all your branches back there or...
I'm just gonna switch. Oops, what do I do here?
Not that this is gonna be any
back to this. And you know, with the wetland in this area, I am concerned about the shading of these trees. So when we replace mature trees with you know, 3-inch caliper trees, we're gonna have less habitat and less shading. The can only be 12 feet tall, and we have a canopy that's 25 to 35 feet up in the air right now. So gonna significantly increase the sunlight and on this, so I need you, I need everyone to look at this area, and you know, we wanna make sure that we're not causing more damage by taking out trees unnecessarily. I mean, obviously this one here would have to come out. But does this one?
Take a look.
Yep. Are the trees that you've identified on these plans, mature trees, are they identified in the field?
Yeah, yeah. They've got the little red or pink tags on them with the numbers. With
oh,
the,
okay.
With those numbers.
I missed that then. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So then we can correlate that.
Yep.
So I would suggest that we need another site visit.
Yeah, I concur.
Okay, any more questions from the commission?
So if is this a commission site visit, or does Jack need to be out there? Because I think we already did one with Steve, and so we got his information. So I wouldn't think Steve is going to need Steve again. Do you need Jack out there to explain anything about the contours and the swales or the or someone from his office?
I don't think so. I think we're just checking the trees, right?
Yeah.
Are we all set with the grading in the back of lots 2 and 3?
2 and 3, yeah.
I'm fine with it. I think the way
okay.
explained the peninsula, where it is in the basement of lot 2, was really the one that we had a discussion on yesterday.
Okay. Kurt, any other questions from the commission? Chuck, you're all set?
Yes.
Any questions from the audience? Mr. Coleman.
Frank Coleman, 26 Randall Road. Can I step up there for a sec? Just
certainly.
Oh, sure thing. Use a pen if you want.
This is good. I'm just kind of building a little on Chuck said. The sun rises up here and comes over like this almost due east to west. And, it, you know, the summer sun is, you know, pretty intense. And I think the neighbors, we've talked it over, we have a little concern, you know, about the eastern sun with all these black dots, these trees going, kind of heating this up quite a bit and, you know, tending maybe to dry it up. And this, which I think everybody kind of thinks is a wetland or agrees is a wetland, there's a little concern about the western sun hitting that and kind of tending to dry it up. And if our goal here is to preserve wetland, I think we have to keep this canopy in mind. Are there any trees in here? Do you remember from your site visit?
It's
yes.
pretty thick in there. And the wetland goes out. It gets broader back there. We didn't walk far
David
back
and I did.
There.
Yeah, we did.
But there are some significant
yes.
trees.
Yep.
And,
was there standing water when you were out there the other day?
No, we were there yesterday. It was pretty dry.
There was no standing water. Sometimes there is out here. And
there's there are quite a few shrubs back there, too. And I remember grasses pretty.
We just have some concern about, I think it's great the trees get replaced, but these are tall trees providing a nice canopy and, you know, very nice shade from the afternoon sun. And when you take those out and put in a seedling, it's going to take many years for that to get tall enough to really give you any sun protection. So that was just, several of us were talking about it, and that's our comment. We're hoping you keep that in mind
mm-hmm.
and preserve as many trees as you can of the mature trees, regardless of what species they are.
So all the black dots are proposed to be cut. So I think when we go out there, that's a really good point. So if we look at tree number 85, 86, 87, if we think there's something there that really provides a lot of shade.
I just was gonna say all the trees are gonna be cut, whether it's a dot or not. There's gonna be
no
trees.
Right, but there's nothing on here that's gonna be saved.
Right,
what I'm
so
saying.
From the 25 foot in,
right.
It's gonna be clear cut
yep.
and graded.
Yep, so, and that makes sense, but you are, to Mr. Coleman's point, going to go from, you know, 50-foot tall oak tree to bare dirt. And when the sun comes in sideways,
definitely.
You get
definitely.
A really considerable, it's going to warm
it
up.
That is a big
so
change.
So we need to look at it. I think what we need to look at as well, though, is you know, this, these are the trees that are within that that zone right there. There's absolutely trees beyond that as well. So I think we need to look at the full canopy.
Right.
I think this is, it.
And the full canopy also, you know, you're still going to have some shading definitely in the existing, what is existing wetland, because they're not
right.
going into yeah. that. So that's not going to get the full brunt of the sun.
Well, it is in the morning and the afternoon. What he's saying is when you've got a 40-foot tree and you take out all the intermediate trees and the adjacent trees, sun comes in sideways underneath the canopy.
Those houses are going to be about 30 feet, 5 feet high, and they're going to block a lot of sun, too. So.
Let's look at it when we get out there.
Yeah. I think it makes sense.
The full canopy needs to be considered when
we're out there. You're extending east to west, and that just happens to be, you know, the track of
yeah.
the sun on, mm-hmm. on that street. And I'm the unfortunate owner of a pool, and I've seen on a hot, hot day, and a pool is a fraction of the area of the wetland, on a hot, hot day, morning it's hot, at night you get a rapid temperature drop, I'll lose 100 gallons in one night. It evaporates up as the warm water goes into the cool air. So I'm well aware of it. You know, we all know what Reading water rates are.
So I think when we go out there, to Mike's point, we'll look at particularly the trees on the two ends here, and if there's something that really stands out as being making sense to save, then we would probably come back to you with a proposal to do
just,
that.
Just if I could make one point is you know, we're really condensed here, and this road is coming up about 6 feet. So by the time you raise this grade and, you know, clear for the foundations, clear for the swales, clear for the detention pond, the replication area, there's just not a lot left. I'm sure Mark would like to save as many trees as he could. He's a big tree guy. And if you see something out there, we'll definitely.
But you guys, I mean, you guys have been good sports all along. I mean, if there's something that we think would be better with some more trees, plant a few more trees, keep peace in the neighborhood, it might not be a bad suggestion.
Jack, how high are you coming up at the end of the cul-de-sac?
6 feet.
6 feet.
And at the base, so we're on lot two right here, it's the same, like 5 feet, four, three?
Probably more like four, three or four.
Yeah, so you can't save any of those trees.
Yeah, I mean, it's like that almost all the way to the corner. Everything
yeah,
rates
so
the
go
back
down.
Corners of the houses, so. A lot of those you're going to have to be filling in above the section. But
you can't save trees like three or four.
Yeah, I know, exactly. So I think it's going to be tough to find us, but I mean, let's get out there, we'll look at the contours, we can do and what we can.
They would provide shade.
I was just going to add something that maybe more for everyone listening, but the commission probably already knows this. Our shade tree policy doesn't give the right to cut down trees, because we have additional interests of the act to also protect, you know, breeding habitat would be the one that comes to mind. And again, replacing fully grown mature trees with smaller trees. So just keep that in mind. Just because they qualified for the shade tree policy and replacement 1-to-1, it's not said and done. And then Jack, I just wanted you to add something, and Mr. Coleman reminded me. I'd like a limit of work line, so we know beyond that you're not doing anything. And if you could just bring it all the way around.
It's actually on the grading plan.
It's on the grading plan?
Yeah. Because
I see all that stopping. I see the erosion control. It says 25-foot line. It stops right where.
Right.
But it's on the grading plan?
Yeah.
Let me see what we got. Yeah. Existing condition, do I have it here? Yeah.
So, you just come down a little bit.
Can we go back up one? Go to the next one. Bit on, is it in this? But you know what I'm saying. I mean, just give us something where we know you're not going beyond. And then when the work starts, show that in the field with a silt fence or construction fence.
Next to the replicated wetlands all over.
I never saw anything over here. And I know that your property line goes, you know, right here, so you're not, you know, obviously you're not gonna do that, but still, we'd like to see, you know. I can email some of this stuff to you guys, if you want.
Can you scan it and send it as an 8.5 by 11?
Take that.
Perfect.
I can email it to whoever else requests it.
Trees aren't soaking it up.
Did you want this back? Check everything.
Oh, you have more.
Are there any more questions from the community? Hearing none, do I have a motion to continue the hearing?
I move we continue the hearing.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Oh, the.
Chuck's got a.
It's that leaf.
Yeah. We have kind of a conflict with Thanksgiving, the next meeting.
December 14th.
Well, are we gonna have another meeting in November?
Well, we're gonna decide that, so right now it's December 14th, and then when we decide, if some, if everyone can make it, then I'll call them.
Okay, and we'll let, Mr. Shields and Mr.
I usually call him Mr. Coleman.
Okay.
Because I have his number, but I can email you, because I have your email address.
Exciting.
Okay, moving right along. You guys are awesome.
We gotcha.
If that's all it takes.
We have a notice of intent for 44 Roma Lane, map 50, lot 36.
What is it?
So, we are opening the meeting.
Say town.
And it's being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act. Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The applicant will present the proposal. Commission will receive reports from the administrator, technical advisors. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and then the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, and you should direct those questions to the chair. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Tierney, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couillard.
David Bennett.
What are you looking for?
Do you, you want me to use what I have?
Not attached to this.
Yeah.
What are you looking for? For his site plan.
I know. Yeah, why don't you put that up there? I don't
plan this.
I thought you were.
Yeah.
Some, I thought someone called and said they were bringing.
All right.
What do you look for?
Did I get it? Mine's right on the back.
Oh, yeah. I fell victim to Ian.
Let me just see what this one is.
I got nothing. I fell victim to Ian.
I'll share.
That's the old one.
Do you have one? A site plan?
I can share with you. That? You don't want to share with me?
No, I'm just wondering if you got it.
So I want to share with you.
I'm going to share with you. I just want to make sure I don't have one. I have one. Is this it?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So I fell victim to myself.
We might be ready.
Everyone ready?
I don't know. I got the right file.
Go.
We might be ready. Hope so.
Alright, I'm Ron Schossel from Osco Associates. I'm representing Matt Carroll here from 44 Warner Lane. I just want to clarify this is actually an NRED, not an NOI.
Mm. Oh, you're right. Sorry.
On September 2nd, earlier this year, I went out there and flagged a small BBW at the neighboring property. It seems to be a drainage channel coming from stormwater drainage further up the road, as a cul-de-sac. The BBW contains winterberries, cinnamon fern, sensitive fern, It doesn't actually come onto the property as far as I can tell. I took multiple soil samples and two DEP dig sheets on the upland side that are included in the packet. Unfortunately, you guys haven't done the site walk yet, so kind of hard to describe it any other way.
Does the water in the ditch flow north to south or south to north?
South to north.
Thanks.
But there's no actual flowing water. It's dry. It was dry at the time. It seems to be only after heavy storms.
Could you please indicate just on the plan where you took upland soil samples?
I took one west of flag A11, right on the other side of the wall, and one between A10 and A9, somewhere out here. I have GPS points. We can supply them on the...
Sure.
Also, I have them still flagged in the field.
Okay, and how deep did you go in those soil samples?
Between 20 and 24 inches deep.
Okay.
I also took multiple other ones in this field right here that are still flagged out there as well. We can take a look at them somewhere out there.
Did you find any hydric soils in those?
No. They're 10YR 5-3, which are close to it, but I was out there on October 10th when I did it. It was bright, sunny, no clouds. I was able to get a full profile on it. And I took multiple samples just to make sure, all over the little opening there. There are now upland plants there. There's a lot of hayseed fern. There's a bunch of oaks growing in that area. Seem pretty clear upland. Actually coming up to the from this side, there's a slight change in topography as it comes up to the wall, which I thought, seeing how this is a flowing when a heavy rain comes through, it's probably not overflowing over the wall onto the property at all.
Were you familiar or did you know about a previous delineation? I have a map from a previous delineation done in 2013.
Yep, I saw the plan after I did the book.
Yeah. Did you take any soil samples?
I could put that on the board.
In those areas?
That's what I was describing earlier.
Let me put this on the board.
Yeah. in that small field right there, that's where I ended up taking the samples.
Can you show me the plot where you took your samples, your upland samples?
One of them
generally
right here.
Yeah.
And the other one somewhere in this range.
Okay.
And then actually I took, I think, 1, 2, 3, 4, something like that, to close out that whole section.
And they all went 20, 24 inch depth?
Yeah.
There were no indications of any...
I didn't see any modeling. The color is close, but there's definitely some brown in it compared to if you're holding it next to the gray, you can definitely tell the difference between a 1 and 2 chroma and a 3 chroma.
I have a question for the applicant. Has there been any filling in your backyard from the time of this delineation to now?
No. So, and if I may, to back up to provide context for the rest of the board, I originally filed for my original permit back in the fall of 2012, in which project was underway. That was essentially the backyard of the house and off to the left on the north side of the house, 20 feet off the house. In June of 2013, on a neighborhood site walk on another project, Chuck walked the property and saw additional clearing outside of the permit that I was given at the time. And I haven't done any work to the left of the house since June of 2013. The plan that is right here was initiated by myself when I came back in front of the board. The exact date, I don't know. I'd imagine it was the following month, sometime in July, where essentially it was brought up that the wetland line needed to be delineated or at least established, in which I volunteered to hire out another party to plot the wetland lines at the time. And I hired out Donahue Associates to plot those on an engineered plot plan. At that point, I shared that with Chuck, but since then, I never filed any other work or filed this publicly on record.
So this plan here?
Yes.
So, Anika, you were on the commission when this, the original, was
yep.
brought before the commission?
Right. And so was Will Finch. I was actually
and
hoping
now,
he was he
now,
been
did
back
you guys
for this,
have a, any kind of a site visit? When you,
you know, I'm gonna go by my memory, take it or leave it. I do recall being in the area where that wetland was delineated, and there was, at the time, it was my memory that there was a certain amount of fill and leveling happening between the house and the stone wall. So the stone wall is that back property line, that straight back property line there. right, thank you. It's my understanding that there was some and this is just my memory, but that there was some soil, topsoil brought in, and it, at that point, it was unclear whether it was a smoothing half foot or whether it was like one or more feet between the house and the stone wall. And I remember it being kind of like graded down, kind of in a line parallel to the side of the house, straight back, but not into the wetland. But I know that there was cutting, there was tree cutting back there, too.
So I'm kidding.
At that time.
If you were on
but you could pull the old file and review it.
So
if you were on a site visit, then there was a previous application for this? Is that? This has been submitted before the board before for an ANRAD.
I don't
yes.
know what ultimately happened to the last
no?
application.
I don't
the
know.
Last
just say your question again. It was there a permit? Yeah, there was a permit
was,
to
was
work directly behind the house.
And 20 feet off to the left.
Oh, and 20 feet off to the left?
Yes, sir.
All right, so I don't remember that part. But I guess when you said I came out and I said don't do this because it seemed that there was an expectation from the commission. It was just an RDA, request for determination,
mm-hmm.
and the applicant had a different understanding of what we allowed, and you know you can see the plan. What's in red there was what Bill Manuel had after this had happened. I said, well, you know what, if you want to be in that area, you're going to need to delineate the wetland because we really never had it delineated before that. We just used the town's GIS maps. And they showed a wetland line beyond the stone wall, just almost just like what we have from Scott here. So when Bill Manuel went out there, he delineated this line in red, which the blue line that winds around is the 25 foot, and the green line is the 35 foot. So that's what we were left with. Until this new delineation by Oxbow
that's
Associates.
That's when the work stopped.
Well, the work had stopped. So I think Matt emailed me the plan, and I emailed it to the commission because they asked for him to delineate the wetland. So that commission then had the plan. So, but then Matt, did you withdraw? Did, or you just decided not to go any?
I decided not to pursue.
Yeah, so we did not pursue anything at that point. I think he's,
question
you know,
on the original.
Definitely wants to get back in there and see what we can do.
Chuck, question on the original, what was it, RDA, with the delineation.
No.
Were there any DEP?
It was no delineation on the original RDA. It was a satellite image from the town's GIS system.
Then how, what was the genesis of that red line, the old one?
It just
after more work than
okay.
was expected, the commission said, well, I said stop first, backed up by the commission, and we asked him to delineate professionally the wetland line.
That delineation
is the red line.
I understand. Were there DEP sheets submitted with that delineation?
No. We
was there
didn't.
Any kind of characteristic characterizing that area of the wetland?
So, no, we only got the plan because the plan was delivered shortly after the delineation was completed and the plan was prepared. And then when I got the plan and we were heading towards a meeting, Matt decided not to to go forward. So there was nothing ever received.
Did you ever go out and look at that area?
I did. Matt would occasionally, I would try to understand what Matt wanted to do, and I would go to the property, and I had been there two to three times.
Do you recall the vegetation in that area?
My recollection was there was sensitive fern in the area,
and you recall
kind of
I
where
saw?
Flag
did,
number
yeah.
12 was.
No. Okay.
And but it, and it was really it was pretty vegetated in the past. It was kind of in its natural state, and then one of the things that had happened was one of the commission members told them that a dead tree could be taken down. And then the next thing you know, everything was taken down in that lot because I think Matt had an expectation where we have jurisdiction over larger trees, but the shrubs can just be cut out at any time. And that's what happened. So that lot was clear cut when, you know, pretty severely clear cut, all the trees are out of there. When Bill Manuel went there to do the delineation, so he had to do that using soils only.
So what year was that? This line
that going? was fall of 2012. Well, I'm sorry, the line was delineated in June of 2013. At the time of the RDA, the permit included 20 feet off the side of the house. During the site walk before the determination, the dead pine off to the left of the house was brought up during the site walk, which wasn't originally within the scope of the original permit, and it was decided that it could be taken down, so it was taken down along with the trees within that 20-foot buffer. To Chuck's point, from there, I did additional clearing of shrub work, of scrub brush, and some small trees, for that matter, outside of that 20-foot foot mark. That's when Chuck and the commission stepped in, and we came to this delineation.
So I just want to add something. You know, I can, although I don't remember it, that 20-foot additional feet beyond the house, I can imagine that was part of it, because that side of his house is almost impossible to get from one side to the other. It's steep and rocky, and you know, looks, you know, so you know, someone coming in and saying, look, I got to make something out here to kind of get from the front to the back. I mean, he doesn't have a great access point on that side of the house, so I can understand, you know, that original permit being the backyard and some additional land on this side. Again, it was a new homeowner. The backyard was covered in trees. There was a roof going on at that time, and the roofer had said, clear the trees out, or you're just going to lose your roof. So all that seemed to be needed and, you know, part of what the commission would grant anyways. but and I've already gone over the story of how we got here. So we have two lines. We have the Oxbow line and we have the Bill Manuel line. The Bill Manuel line seemed reasonable every time I went out there and we tried to talk about something. And Matt has come in to try to move this process forward. And if we can figure out which line is right, then you know we'll know what's going on. And this is what I asked him. I asked him to get a delineation and to file a notice of intent for any work that he's going to do, because that's what it would need. Not really sure if the Oxbow line is approved, if he'll need a notice of intent, but we'll just see. What the project is.
I think to go forward with this, I think we haven't been out to the site, and I would encourage the consultant to be there, because you know in other areas that where we've had can't figure out the line, you know we've taken a real close look at hydric soils and vegetation, so we would definitely want to do that.
I agree. I think that's a smart way to go about this.
I have a question. Was there any filling that occurred?
It was a really rough slope next to the house. I think there was castings from the foundation, and certainly when Matt did the lawn in the backyard with all the extensive grading that he did, and I guess he put some rocks out there. I don't know if they're still there or not, but
they were taken up out of the backyard.
They might have
put the lawn in the backyard.
It might have spilled a little bit into it, but unless it's manicured, I would assume that it hasn't been touched.
Yeah, that's so. My question is, was there any significant filling done after that red line was established?
I've driven past there for other projects. I didn't see any. Occasionally I would see some more stone wall being built at the very by the street, but nothing substantial. So I would say no. I don't think so.
So, again, to reiterate, since that line has been delineated, I haven't done a thing to it. I'd welcome you folks to come out and I guess validate that. To Chuck's point about stone wall across the front of the sidewalk, my kids are to blame for that for the plantings they do in that at the summertime. But other than that, it is what it is from that time.
So really, what we have is a previous plan that wasn't granted an ANRAD, wasn't confirmed or denied. So really, it's just a point of reference for us. We're going to go out and look at Matt's line and use this as a point of reference and see if Matt's line holds water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No pun intended.
No pun intended. Pretty straightforward. So let's continue and do a site walk.
Do you guys have a
stop that gentleman.
Yeah, really? Just reiterated what I had talked about. Thank you, Al.
I said it better.
Concise.
Yeah, right.
He summarized.
I said it faster.
No, you didn't.
So we'll just set some. Can we set up a site walk now, or do you want to do it email? Let's do it through email. So since the pause.
When everybody's available. Are there any comments from the community? Hearing none.
I move we continue this.
Can you start off the process by
all those in
usually
favor?
Between 12 and 2 is a good time.
You just make sure Chuck knows who
Monday
voted
through Thursday. Yeah. Can you start off by just sending me some dates?
Yeah, no problem.
All right.
Chuck.
Thank you very much.
Continued. I second it. All in favor?
Who?
Anika. Continue.
Mike.
Okay.
I second it. And all in favor.
The next item on the agenda is a public hearing for DEP. We don't have a number yet, but it's 364 Lowell Street, map 26, lot 157, Jamesons. And is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Applicant presents the proposal. Commission will receive reports. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and then the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which you should direct to the chair. I'd like to introduce members of the commission, starting on my right.
David Pinnett.
Al Couliard.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, chair.
Anika Scanlon, vice chair.
Michael Flynn. Chuck Tirone, conservation administrator.
Members of the commission, my name is William Crowley. I'm an attorney. My office is at 159 Haven Street. I represent the proponent, Jameson Properties. With me is David Jameson and our wetlands management expert, Bill Hamish. I wanted to give just a brief introduction of the history, both on the applicant and the property itself. Jameson family business was started 4 years ago. 1969. Mother and father. They're still very much involved with the business. And the children are now pretty much running the business. They build and manage quality properties and have done so for several decades. This site itself is located on Lowell Street, and it was originally laid out in the late 1800s, and it was a huge tract of land, and it fell on both sides of Lowell Street. In 1925, there was a subsequent plan laid out, recorded at the registry of deeds, a lot of papers were signed. Obviously, parcels sold off, subdivided, streets put in. And we come down to this parcel, which is really the last of the original property, consisting of 2.574 acres of land. It's on the southerly side of Lowell Street, and just past Plymouth Road. The property was in the Lyle family since 1925. And when the last of the Lyles passed away a few years ago, the property was sold to the Jameson family. Their proposal is to subdivide, well, first of all, to rehabilitate the existing home at 364 Lowell Street to add a garage on the back, and to subdivide the 2.5 acres behind it into three lots for the purpose of that. Interestingly, we are here because of wetlands that were actually created by this town, we believe, back in the 1930s. A drainage ditch was dug by this town. There is a sewer grate, a catch basin, on Lowell Street where the street runoff captures the water from Lowell Street and dumps right into this drainage ditch. Well, unfortunately, the town never maintained this drainage ditch throughout the decades. Sand, silt, road runoff, debris clogged it up. There's a culvert way down, runs underneath the railroad tracks at the end of the Dustin Road. Never maintained, clogged up. Consequently, it backed up, a lot of backed up, spread. So I think had proper care been taken over the 70 years or so by the town, we might not be here, at least not here today. That being said, a few years ago, the Jamesons were before this commission with a proposal similar to what we have today. After a couple of hearings before the commission, it was decided that there was a lot that we wanted to do to make sure that proper attention was paid to the existing wetlands and that care was taken to make sure that a nice plan was being proposed. So our team including our engineer and our wetlands management people, have met with town engineering, with planning. Planning has looked at it. They like what we have now. We're in queue to get back before CPVC once we have it vetted here and we hear suggestions and comments from the commission. And we welcome those comments, and we will incorporate those comments into the plan itself. That is an overview. I'd like now to turn over to our expert, Bill Manuel, who can fill you in on the details. Oh, I must say also that apparently this commission has not had an opportunity to get into a site walk, mainly because the flags have not been planted to define where the proposed houses and decks and garage were going to be. We need to get down in time. So for tonight, really what we want to do is kind of give you a flavor, give you a sense, give you an overview. We don't necessarily have to get into a lot of details, but certainly we'll explore whatever questions this commission may have. But we do want to at least give you a broad overview, and then it will be flagged next week.
Pretty soon.
Pretty soon. And then arrangements can be made to have this commission go out and do the sidewalk. Then we'll come back for another visit. So with that,
turn
this over to Bill Manuel.
Thank you. Chuck, here's the
My name is Bill Manuel. And when I say pretty soon, as far as staking out, half of it is staked out. Chuck and I had a conversation. I must have misunderstood what he was looking for. We actually staked out the roadway, this edge of the detention basin, corners of the house here, and this side of the roadway. And Chuck has asked that we now take out that house, and the other corners here. And there's enough wooden grade stakes out there that are marked and numbered that when we schedule a site walk, I'll get there an hour earlier and I'll complete that stake out. And so that's why I say pretty soon, whenever we schedule that site walk, we'll have it done before then. So as Attorney Crowley has discussed, this is a four-lot subdivision, and what we tried to do, this is the second pass through with the Conservation Commission. We've formalized some of the things that we talked about back in 2014. It's basically a new commission. So I want to go over the things that we did. But we basically incorporated improvements and minimized houses, and were able to get a couple of houses completely out of buffer zone from the previous filing. We're very constrained. First of all, the wetlands, we did an ANRAD back in 2013. This is Lowell Street, and I flagged the wetlands and extended, along the water course and goes off-site here, and then this is the MBTA rail line, and there's a culvert that goes under this sewer line here. And then there's another culvert that goes under the railroad grade. There's a culvert that empties into this site here from Lowell Street. The ORAD recently expired. It expired in July, but we can take a look at the flags. I don't think anything has changed that the line is going to have any significant deviations from where it was. What we'd like to do, this is the existing home right here. And this was the driveway that came into the home here. And all of this is kind of disturbed. It's been basically improved with that sort of reclaimed asphalt. And there's a clearing, and there's some dense grade material. And I prepared this plan over here. And I'm sorry if some of you can't quite see it. But what I'm trying to illustrate here is that where there is patched gray or orange, that's already disturbed area. This is the driveway to the existing house. It's a garage under. And so there is a driveway right here. You can see that we'd like to put an addition on this home here.
it basically falls over that existing driveway. Here's our road layout, and you can see it's already impacted with dense grade material, including up into the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation and the 35-foot structure zone. And then we have clearing beyond that. So, you know, the area where we are sort of going into your subzones, and I'll talk about that later, it's already impacted. And I'm not sure that point was really brought out at the last time. We did have some site visits, but we went to the step of having that illustrated for this go-around. So Chuck, why don't we go down to, I think, sheet 3?
Bill, can I ask you a real quick question? The previously disturbed area, why was that disturbed? Was it part of another project?
No, it's just the homeowner, the previous homeowner, he had his driveway, and this is a paper street layout, and it just cleared it, made it a driveway. There was a boat that was parked back here for a while, and so, you know, that sort of thing. Was it much more than like a really wide driveway?
Okay.
So here's the proposal. And again, we have the existing home right here, and what we'd like to do is add this addition so that we're going to rehabilitate that existing home, and so that it fits in with the three new homes that we're going to do. Here's our roadway. One of the things you'll see is that the roadway does not coincide with the center of the road layout. What we've done is we've pushed it, offset it to the north there, so that we can provide additional separation from the wetlands for this addition here. That was an issue the last time around. We have three new homes. This one is outside of your no build and no disturb zone, but it is in the buffer zone. And here's the buffer zone line right through here, and you can see that we have positioned two homes completely outside the buffer zone and nothing but grading, and each lot has their own little bioretention cell. Those happen to fall in the buffer zone. That's an improvement from the last time as well. What we've done is we've had smaller houses, so it gave us opportunity for shifting them more on the lots to get those outside buffer zones. We think we've done a good improvement with that respect. This is the stormwater management area. And basically, this is a detention / infiltration basin. We've done soil analysis on the property. They're A soils. They're excellent sandy, coarse sand soils. They're mapped as Merrimack sandy loam soils. And so we are able to actually infiltrate all of the site runoff between the basin here, and each site has either their own little rooftop runoffs. We've got, you know, Cultec chambers here and here, two on each lot, and then each lot for the driveways has their own little sort of bioretention cell built in. And all of that will completely infiltrate up to the 100-year storm, with no increase in volume or peak flows for the site.
So Bill, could you say again what flows into the retention basin?
The roadway.
The roadway.
So
the new road here, nothing from Lowell Street?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Or does the basin at the bottom right-hand corner, that pipe runs out?
Basin at the bottom right corner. Are you talking this?
Yeah.
That's going to be a mitigation area. I'm going to talk about that later.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So all of this work, we've done the best we can to try to keep it out of your subzones. This garage addition is going to fall within the 35-foot no structure zone. The previous go-around, that little addition, because the roadway was further to the south, was centered in the layout, that the structure was actually in the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation. We've removed that. We do have a little bit of grading in the zone of natural vegetation, but right now, this is a sort of, right now it's casually maintained as a lawn,
They've,
sorry.
Keeping that mowed, around the house, or keeping it mowed?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's basically a maintained lawn that we're approaching into.
It's tough to see on the lens. Where, you know, I assume where that's coming off, that just, the house, the existing house connects to.
Wait a second, guys.
Outline that a little bit.
Yep, this is the existing structure right here.
All right, thank you.
And then we're going to connect on to that. And then the driveway, or the roadway cul-de-sac, it extends into the 20, here's the 25 line right through here, and here's the 35 line right through there. You see our infiltration basin is completely outside the 25 line. We intend for this to be remain as a undisturbed vegetation. We intend to do some mitigation here, which I'll get to. But the cul-de-sac bulb does extend into that, but I want to refer you back to this. Here we go. It's already, a lot of it is already impacted by that dense grade material. So we do have to ask a waiver for encroaching into that zone, but a lot of it's already impacted. I think there's the total, if we just disregard what's already been impacted, the total is, I forget the exact number, it's around 1,300 square feet of impact into the no disturb and the no structure in the zone of natural vegetation. To support our request for a waiver, we've incorporated extensive mitigation into this project. First of all, as Attorney Crowley has said, a major source of the hydrology for this wetland system is input from Lowell Street, untreated input. What happens right now is there is a discharge pipe, there is a block head wall, and the discharge pipe is flush with the face of the wall about 3 feet up. So the water just, in a heavy rain event, the water just shoots out of there. And what it's done is it's scoured the stream bed here. There's a lot of sediment that is getting washed in, getting carried down and washed into this wetland system. There is a large sort of delta of sandy material that has accumulated over the years in this area. And what we'd like to do, number one, is put an outlet, a control flow diffuser at this outlet. So it'll be a T structure. It'll direct the water down, and we'll put a rock splash pad right at the where the water is directed down. So that will stop the scouring that's occurring right now in that stream bed. We would also like to remove this material under somebody like myself, a wetland scientist direction, and we're going to do that with hand tools and just get that material right out of the stream bed and sort of enhance the flow that goes through here. We would like to walk this entire length and pick out all the trash. There's plastic liquor bottles, soda bottles, water bottles, kids' toys, whatever, that all through the collected in this weather. We'd like to clean all that up. This area in here is an infestation of Japanese knotweed, and you can see my wetland line. See how it comes out and it creates this little thing here? That really constricts the flow of water. And during the last time around, we had several neighbors along Plymouth Street say that they have to go out in this area and actually hand shovel and clean that out to keep the water flowing, otherwise they get flooding. Well, it turns out that basically you can see this is not a really natural wetland line, so I'm basically from here, right across to here, is all historic fill, and that's probably where the knotweed came in on, as it probably came in on dirty fill, and so what we like to do was, number one, rub out that knotweed, and just remove all that historic fill that's in there, and we're going to restore this as an emergent marsh type wetland, which will blend in well with the wetland area, which is right around in here. That will give more floodwater storage capacity. It will eliminate this constriction in the stream, and it'll get rid of that noxious weed. What we'd also like to do, these areas here that are sort of in orange or cream color, those are look rather large piles of landscape debris, and they're not placed there legally, but we're willing to deal with it and get it out of there. What will happen is we will probably put down sheets of plywood and so that we can get across this wetland area, and then just using hand tools and wheelbarrows, cart all that landscape debris out of there. Chuck, if you could slide the plan over, I guess, to my right a little bit.
Mr. Manuel?
Yes.
Quick question. The wetland restoration area there between the cul-de-sac and the current mm-hmm. flagged wetlands, do you have a rough square feet?
2,590. How's that for rough?
It's pretty rough. 2,590.
Right. And so moving down the line, this culvert, and actually if you could slide the plan down a little bit, Chuck. Oh, wait. Yeah. Here, this culvert here, what happens is that this sewer line obstructed the flow. What used to happen is the water used to come in and then just go on the other side of this berm and then go onto the culvert at the MBTA tracks. And now it's kind of trapped, and it's got to go this way first and get under this little 12-inch diameter pipe that is basically clogged with organic material. What we'd like to do is clean that pipe out and then retrofit that with sort of a trash guard where it'll stop the debris from getting in there, and also provide sort of a port for you to get in there in the future to clean it out and just make sure we have positive flow through that area. When we went to the DRT meetings, that's sort of mitigation was highly supported by the engineering department. So, and then what we also like to do is we want to put signage along here. We show actually the plans on our mitigation plan. We show the signage on the wetland line, but really what we want to do is put the signage right along the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation line. And that would say something to the effect of it's environmentally sensitive area, stay out, or, you know, whatever we'll work out the wording. We'd also put that signage along here for the benefit of these property owners as a reminder that landscape is not a great place for landscape debris. And so we have a significant program for mitigation in support of our waiver request. As I said, we try to incorporate as much infiltration as possible. We don't increase volume or rate of runoff in a 100-year storm event. I think that's basically an overview of what we're trying to accomplish.
Just a couple of questions. That structure coming off of Lowell Street, you're going to have to deal with Mass Highway Department. Don't they maintain Lowell? Because it's a state route.
I don't know the answer to that question, but I'll pose that to the engineer.
Yeah, it's Route 129.
Yeah, good luck with that. And also, going underneath the railroad track, cleaning out that pipe, you're going to have to deal with MVTA.
Yep.
Is that on railroad property? With it?
Well, I'm off. Chuck, how about sliding that down so we can see there? I want to see by the MBTA tracks, please.
What are you asking, Dave?
The property that is shown above there, where it's in the rectangle, where he's showing that's where the 12-inch pipe with the
right.
trash grate is going to go under.
Yeah.
Yep.
Whose property is that?
That's ours.
Oh.
This little extension here is ours.
Oh, okay.
And I have two questions. When you mentioned the sewer pipe, this is a storm drain, right? Or it's not.
It's a sewer.
It's a sewer. Okay.
It's buried. Buried right here. It's like the high ground between this wetland and this wetland. There's actually it's. You'd think it was a levee, sort of like a levee, but it's a linear ridge.
I see what you're saying.
Soil probably 6 feet tall.
And that's parallel to the tracks.
Correct.
Okay, and it, the water today goes over it or under it?
Kind of around it. There's a break in the, there's a sort of a break down in this area here.
Okay.
Well, there's a, I think there's also a break closer to your pipe.
Yes.
And I think it's got a small pipe, small submerged pipe.
That's the one we want to clean out.
Oh, but that isn't, oh, I thought you were cleaning out the one that goes under the railroad track.
We
not
would like
the one
to do that,
that
as well, but we want to also, this 12-inch is probably the real problem.
The one that connects one part of
yes
the mini canal, I don't use that word lightly, to the other,
right,
one, closer to the tracks.
Right.
And then my last question.
That wouldn't require MBTA, I don't think.
No,
it's
if,
not
it's,
no.
if that's your property, but if anything underneath the railroad, you'll have
one
to deal with it.
We'll get them to do it.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Pretty good.
My last question is just the so the water flowing along the northeast bottom property line.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, would you call that an intermittent stream? Is that just a wetland? Is that
there is flow, there's gradient. The engineer went through there and actually took shots. All down, actually it was in the winter, he took shots on the top of ice. So there is a positive gradient. It is an intermittent stream within the interior of it. And there is a vegetated wetland adjacent to that intermittent stream.
Okay, thanks.
Bill, I just want to make sure I understand the variance request clearly. So there's three bullets in here. The first is a variance for section 3.25 to construct a portion of the garage. So that's lot one, the garage that's within the 35-foot zone. The second is variance 3D-2 to construct a portion of the roadway and utilities and house addition on lot one within the 25-foot. And then the second is...
Grading for lot one.
Okay.
The addition is out, but the grading is in.
All right.
On lot one.
All right. That's what I wanted to clarify. I wasn't sure what the difference in.
Okay. And one thing that I'd like some clarification on is the infiltration basin. I have not counted that as a structure. And so I accordingly have not asked for any waiver or variance on that because it is a detention basin, and I'm going to ask the commission to count stormwater management features as structures.
I believe generally, typically we do. Chuck, I thought that was the case, but...
Because basically it's creating a hole in the ground with some piping.
Yeah, in the past we have, and within the 25-foot... Which are, I don't think you're in that, but temporary or permanent, in the 35-foot, it's permanent structure. So we usually go by the dictionary definition of a structure.
Would this require engineering?
To build it?
No. Would it require approval from engineering department?
They would have to maintain it if the road was taken over. So they would have to approve it.
Do you mean to approve the design?
Mm-hmm.
Capacity.
Bill, you want to speak to the, you know, engineering's involvement to date on this?
Yeah, engineering, both the prior and the current engineer, have reviewed these plans pretty extensively and worked closely with Bill and also with Thad Berry. And they're very much on board with this proposal. I don't know what they're in, because I didn't ask the question, whether or not they consider it a structure, this retention basin.
But they're definitely involved in the planning board side in review of this entire design. And then how many meetings have you had with the planning board?
Well, one so far, that there were preliminary meetings, and several meetings with engineering and downstairs at zoning as well, planning.
So we feel like we're pretty well vetted with on the planning side, including engineers. And I'm sure once the final plans are, and we're going back to planning board after we get a good comfortable feeling with your commission, and I'm sure we'll get down to the nuts and bolts of it. But conceptually, I think we're there.
I think on first blush, then we would consider this as a structure. I mean, if we've done this before, I don't want to break precedent.
Yeah.
Then I'll amend my waiver request.
Okay.
I kind of recall the last time we didn't call it a structure, but that's fine. I think we have adequate mitigation to cover everything that we're asking for.
The garage, so it's within the 35 foot. How far away is it proposed?
Which lot?
Lot one.
One.
Right now, there's flag A11 kind of jumps up a little bit higher than the rest of them, and it is about 29 feet from that one flag A11. So A11, A12 are about the same height. So about 29 feet. But one of the benefits of that addition there is we put that on now that the garage, the driveway, is now up here. What happens now with the existing home, if you were to say, forget it, we're not giving you that waiver, then we would just rehabilitate the home and use the existing driveway, which now comes down and is here and enters into the garage under. And so at this point, you're about 15 feet from the edge of wetlands. And so if we do this, yeah, we need a waiver, but what we're doing is now we're putting the cars almost 60 feet, or like 58 feet. Now the separation and now a structure is between us and the wetland. And then, as I mentioned, we pushed the road offset on the layout, so we were able to get a few more feet, and that pushes everything up this way.
So you're saying if we don't give you the garage, then you have something you can do by right, it sounds like.
The driveway's there. And
it's already there.
It's existing.
Yeah.
No, there's a driveway there now.
Yeah,
yes,
there is.
That's right. Oh, yeah, that's right. There is something there.
And with this plan, excuse me for interrupting, but where the easterly edge of that proposed garage is located is actually set further away from the wetlands than the current driveway. Is that correct?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So that part, which is currently now paved driveway, will actually be taken up and seeded and planted and become grass.
I kind of hesitate to ask the question because this looks like a very preliminary design, but can that garage be, something that, as you know, has come up in previous projects, stuff like that, are sort of ancillary attachments to the house, decks, walkouts, bulkheads, stuff like that. And when I'm looking at a plan like that, I don't know if that's going to be a garage with a part foundation built into the side, with a walkout in the back, or, I don't know if you could put any of that sort of to rest about, the layout of the house and any extra structures.
Yeah, we're not talking about any walkout behind the garage, and you can see the proposed grading. I'd say this is a little bit more than preliminary, because we're putting it on the plan. That's what we're asking to build.
Okay.
So the grading that's shown here is that, this level of the driveway now is going to be sort of the finished floor level of the house, and the land does drop off. So we're just kind of grading around it. And so you can see we're just trying to get back down to original grade there. So there's no walkout behind that garage. And so the foundation wall, basically, is we're going to fill up against it.
So you'll have a frost wall and a slab under the garage.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna jump to something else. So the area, the area of illegal dumping that's adjacent to Detail A, it's that pipe near the railroad track. Is that the same fill area? I'll wait till Chuck gets to it. Page up, please.
Gotcha.
Yep. Thank you. Yep. Is that the fill area at the end of what, Dustin? Is that Dustin right there? You take that lovely.
That's off our property and there's nothing we can do about that one.
Oh, because it's a lovely color of, you're gonna get rid of that. That's a, I'd love to see that one gone, but I understand it's off your property.
That one is beyond our control.
I know, you colored it lovely. I'm going to remove this color.
I'm just pointing out, you know, maybe by two functions there. As Attorney Crowley mentioned early in this presentation, that this is a highly impacted wetland area. And so we're just trying to illustrate all the areas of impact that do occur right around, sort of like the last island that hasn't been developed and it's sort of getting all the abuse.
Immediate impact. I'm going to ask about, as you might remember from the ANRAD, I remember a lot of stuff about it. I think somebody who was on the Conservation Commission at the time submitted some field data to NHESP. Do you remember that, Chuck?
Yeah.
To as potential evidence of a vernal pool in that wetland back there. Chuck, can you remind me the status of that?
So,
submittal?
We on the last go round, it was a vernal pool discussion, and we went out there two times during vernal pool season to wade out into the wetland and around the drainage ditch by the railroad tracks and to see what we could find. We did find one frog, one spring peeper. It was dead. And we took pictures, and Bill Manuel was there too. So it was myself, Will Finch, and I don't know who else. Maybe, were you there?
I didn't know. I wasn't fortunate.
Oh, Bill Hacked?
He didn't put the waders on, but he was there at least one of the occasions.
Supervisor.
So that was a thorough search for, you know, frog eggs, for any kind
no
of sign.
No evidence of egg masses,
no evidence.
Lots of singing.
There was chorusing that was recorded, but I don't, you know, to be honest with you, we never really identified where it was coming from.
And that whole area is surrounded by wetlands.
Well, there's a lot of wetlands. So it's Plymouth Road. There's wetlands
south of that,
towards town,
right
on Plymouth Road,
right.
And that could be a possible spot. So we, you know, I felt like we really looked for a vernal pool. It still might be a potential vernal pool. So let's just get back. So Natural Heritage was sent an application. They denied it. They asked for better recordings, longer, more robust, and I don't believe there were any found, or we didn't have any at that point, and there was none taken the next year. And I think that's kind of where it stayed. So
okay.
When Bill says some of those plaques, I mean, I thought someone on the commission might say, well, we provide plaques. What they're doing there is they're going to identify that area in back of lot 2 as a more sensitive area than what we regularly do. And you know, maybe not call it out as a vernal pool, but, you know, try to get as much precaution taken in that area just in case. But it was thoroughly looked through.
And where exactly is the
what?
Reported vernal pool in question?
I'd like to address that if I may. I'm sorry to interrupt, but I had a conversation with Jacob Kubel, who is the conservation scientist with the Mass Initial Fisheries and Wildlife about this issue. gave him as much information as I could provide to him. I asked him to look through his files to see what, if anything, has been determined for vernal pools in that area, but specifically to 364 Lowell Street. And he wrote a letter back to me, an email, which I'll read to the board and give you a copy if you'd like. But it says, thanks for your call and message earlier this afternoon regarding the previous vernal pool application for 364 Lowell Street. I was able to track down the report, which we had assigned tracking number B965. We originally reviewed the report on October 14, 2014, and rejected it for being incomplete. There was no recording of the alleged frog chorusing and no photo of the pool. A series of videos with audio and photos of the pool was subsequently submitted on January 6, 2015. We rejected the application a second time on January 9, 2015 because the alleged, quote, full chorusing of frogs was not discernible in any of the recordings submitted. To date, no additional information about the pool has been submitted, and so it is not considered a certified vernal pool. And we identified that a certified vernal pool number 294, which was raised as a potential one being on this property. Certified vernal pool number 294 does not coincide with 364 Lowell Street, and unless proven to the contrary by an approved resource delineation. Based on the documentation provided to us and stored in our file to date, the location of the pool is between the railway and the western and southern boundaries of 34 Public Road. I hope you find this information useful. So I think it's been vetted, submitted, and rejected, and I don't think we need to discuss that any further.
So we're not really talking about the vernal pool that Bill just identified. So this comes up because Fran Fink went out to this last house on Plymouth Road, and they were doing something out there, a deck or whatever, and she wrote in her report potential vernal pool. So
she wrote vernal pool, no potential, excuse me.
And so it's that, is it that circle?
She probably forgot the word potential because she, you know, it wasn't verified, so it can't be a potential, it can't be a vernal pool. So
this is the area we're talking about.
Okay.
Basically right in here.
Okay, thanks.
I think between Chuck, myself, and former Commissioner Finch, we put the waders on, I recall, three different times. And I think I calculated a collective effort of about 8 hours scouring an area, I'd say twice as big as this room. I think we, and at no time, and this was during the vernal pool season, they were chorusing in other parts of Middlesex County, Middlesex County. We should have found evidence. And, you know, my feeling is that the water quality is so impaired here. It just, the junk is coming off the street. I just don't think that it's a viable habitat, for that, a breeding habitat for that sort of thing. But we looked and didn't come up with anything.
I've got another question. With the reestablishment of a wetland in between the cul-de-sac and the current wetland line,
mm-hmm.
Is there going to be a need for any additional grading or in that area? Because
yep.
I don't see any grading or walls
right
proposed.
Plan,
or
these are proposed contour lines.
Oh, okay.
So we are going to pull that fill back. I think the magic number is 190 that we're shooting for.
I would greatly appreciate one big plan.
I've got the big plans.
Do you have the big plans?
Yep.
Just the one.
Yes, we're trying to match the elevation of the existing or the adjacent wetland, which is about 189. And then my proposal there, after it's rubbed out, it will bring in new material, new topsoil, and then seed that with a wet mix.
Detail.
Just wondering, is that grading, do you think, what's the steepest slope along that proposed grade?
After we're done?
Yeah. Yeah, what do you think?
3 to 1 or flatter.
So on C3, there's that outlet, does they actually zoom in on that area? Are you looking at that?
Just looking at a bigger, yeah.
Okay, so. In this area, as we're transitioning to the upland, Anika, that's going to be a 2 to 1 slope right there.
Yep, okay. Alright, so it's less steep than 3 to 1.
And we could make it, we could have made it a 3 to 1, but we're trying to maximize the amount of restoration that we're providing.
And I know I'm asking you to explain a lot, but could you just go over the rough description of the BMPs again, the purple? Just the ones between the street and the wetland.
Okay, so quickly, each house has a pair of underground infiltration chambers for the roof.
Yep.
Each lot has their own sort of bioretention cell that's designed to pick up all the runoff from the driveway, so that on each individual lot, there is no runoff from the lot. What we're doing for the infiltration / detention is the runoff is collected and run through deep sump catch basins. It then is directed to this structure right here, which is a 500-gallon sort of inline sediment forebay. And once it runs through that, it's directed into the basin. And this is a fairly unique design that takes advantage of the excellent soils. If you go to the detail sheet,
which one?
Which is
C6.
C6. And right down, keep going straight down the page, right from there. Maybe a little over. Keep going down.
I think you're on 5.
Oh, that's not what I hear for 6.
Go up a little bit there.
No, I think you go down. That's page 5,
seven.
We want 6.
Seven.
Mm-hmm. All right. So what happens? That's perfect. There is a this is the sort of the outboard side. It's a berm. It does have a grass weir overflow in case there's some sort of monumental storm. What happens is that there should never be any outflow in a 100-year event. The water's going to come in, it's going to fill up to just below this elevation here. You can see that the bottom of the infiltration area is all washed, crushed stone encapsulated in filter fabric. And this is a sort of a catch basin grate inlet that the water will flow into, and then it has two distribution pipes which spread the water out to both sides underground through this crushed stone. It will percolate out, it will fill up the voids in here, but eventually the basin will percolate out into the soils.
Can, if you don't happen to know the 100-year storm amount of rain, is it?
We have used the Cornell numbers, and the regional curves for this area is, I think, 7.1 inches.
Okay. Yep, thank you.
Was some 3/4. What were you talking about?
So I'll set, well, you can look at, I'll show you the map. I'll show you the map. You can pick a number. It's not a, as you can tell.
Depending on where you are in the range. So we've used
7.1 is a lot better than 6.5. Where's my pictures?
The Cornell maps are a larger scale.
So for the sake of the the audience to explain the Cornell data. A lot of weather data is that people typically use to model what type of storm they expect to see is based on data that stopped collecting rain precip data in the 60s, the 70s. But there have been a lot more extreme weather events since then. So the new precip data shows, well, according to, you know, if you're going to take their first one of their maps, it shows Reading to be definitely above 7.5. You know, something for this map, and I don't know what this data, what years this was based on, but, and 100 years starting from what year ago, but so the last design we reviewed got, I think it's hard to get this new updated climate, new storm information down to engineering for them to give out the right information to the applicants to do these design storms, because the last project, Randall Road, is they designed for 6.5-inch 100-year storms. And if you interpolate...
And that was provided directly from engineering.
And that was provided directly from engineering, so I don't know if engineering... So I'll talk to engineering about what data they use and how up-to-date they are with being able to design for storm capacities that Reading's going to see, that it is seeing and is going to see. So I think that's an important data correction that needs to happen on our permits. So 7.1 inches, I don't know if that's within the margin of error of what we're seeing, but it's at least closer than 6.5. So.
Right. Remember, we're modeling runoff. I mean, if you get it a half CFS, you know,
right.
0.1, what does that mean? 0.1 of the CFS.
Right, I don't know what
so,
the design.
You know, whole numbers is really a more realistic approach.
So,
any other questions from the commission?
I'm sorry, this is an easy one, I think. The clean out access cover. So, how do you keep those pipes from silting out?
Well, because everything's going number one through the deep sump catch base and then number through the. The containerized sediment forebay.
And then
so
does it
discharge? It should be.
And does it discharge above grade there and then drops into the catch basin?
It will, as the storm increases,
the
duration of the storm length, this basin will fill up. At the same time, water is running into here.
Okay, all right, thanks.
So, Bill, I guess some of the conversations we've been having on other developments. You guys put together a tree inventory plan.
Yes.
Is that inclusive of every tree that's on the lot, the trees that are being proposed to be taken out? What's the...
We have an inventory plan of every tree. I forget what the number was, 4 inches, 6 inches? Every tree.
3 inches plus.
On the lot.
Yeah. Yes. What's the proposed removal?
Now let's go back to the site plan. I'm making it work, actually. I would say four is good, or I could just refer to this plan.
See, yeah.
And if you can reduce the scale of that, zoom out. So what we are trying to do is these trees that are indicated around the edges here, we would like, those are natural trees that are that we've inventoried, and we'd like to keep those. We the grading and the house construction won't impact those as far as we can tell, so we'd like to keep them. Beyond that, you can expect that basically everything within the 25 zone, all through here, and up into this area will be removed. I don't have a number for you, but...
So I've got a total of 190 on the inventory list.
I got 210.
I could be doing math.
I don't know. But we don't know how many.
We don't know how many are outside of the, our.
Yeah, we, I mean, this is.
Jurisdiction.
That's not our jurisdiction.
Yeah, there's, so there's a big area outside our jurisdiction.
Right.
And we have a tree replacement policy that the commission adopted a couple months ago, maybe 3-4 months ago, that of the mature trees over a certain diameter within our jurisdiction, which would be the 100, within 100 feet of a resource area, we look for either a one-to-one replacement with a smaller caliper-sized tree, or three native bushes, or some kind of monetary
contribution
to a tree replacement fund. If on a site you couldn't stick those trees back in.
Do you know
your name? Oh, I'm sorry. Somebody else.
My name is Jocelyn. I live at 374 Lowell. And I know they want to leave. There's two large trees there. One is about 100 feet tall. It's a pine tree. It's right on my land. That would have to come down if that lot is cleared out because of danger. If that was ever to have a windstorm. Right now it's buffeted by the forest behind it. So there's two trees there at least. They're on the property. They have to come down. Now, I don't know if you folks would have to do it. I would have to do it, but that can't stay there. 100 feet, sole tree. It would be a dangerous situation. So just for you to put it to the record or whatever.
So one thing to keep in mind here, and because there are a lot of trees that are marked here and on the lot, our jurisdiction is with 100 feet and of the wetland buffer. So there's going to be a lot of trees that we discuss that are going to be out, or that are really aren't going to be discussed, that are outside of that zone as well.
Sounds like he's outside that.
There's definitely some trees within that are going to be impacted. We'll try to get you that number.
Okay.
Have we done a site visit? Are we going
no,
to?
No, we have not. Okay. There are a couple things I'd like to bring up. Are we all set with the fees?
We're not.
Okay.
We have to discuss the fees.
Okay.
Reconcile fees. And I have a question. There are two homes that we are proposing, but they're outside of the buffer zone. Are you due a fee for the homes that are outside the buffer zone? I've calculated that as category one, where we're working in the buffer zone, but the house is outside.
Well, you have driveways in those areas that are within our jurisdiction. Now, the fees, yeah, well, the whole thing, yeah. But when we have to look at something, you know, that fee is to defray some of the cost of our not ours, but our staff's review. So, yeah, we would include that.
So, per lot?
Per lot, right.
Any jurisdiction.
And, you know, we have to look at the whole drainage system, and that includes, you know, everything, even off-site, actually. You know, if you're getting a catchment, sub-catchment basin someplace else, you know, and contributing into those detention, retention basins.
All right. The two questions I had were the infiltration basin, whether that's a structure, and so we've got to do the variance on that, but also there's money associated with that as well.
Yes.
So we'll reconcile that, we'll reconcile the houses, and Chuck will go back and forth, make sure the numbers are right, and we'll get you another check.
Okay. We haven't
had... Did you mention the historic fill area?
I've treated that as mitigation. Excellent question. This removal of historic fill, I've suggested that as mitigation, albeit in support of our waiver request. I have not calculated that into the fee for work within the zone of natural vegetation. Is that something that you're going to charge us for providing mitigation?
We've done this on Randall Road in the mitigation area.
Yeah, generally I think we require, because the mitigation wouldn't be occurring if we weren't having something else done. I think
right.
We've generally required that.
So the answer is yes? We haven't had a site visit because not all of the buildings were staked out, and we would like to see that relationship too.
Can I ask that the flat, that the trees within 100 feet that are proposed to stay get flagged? Because that'll be less work than flagging the ones that are not gonna stay. Does that make sense?
Yeah, we'll try to.
It's gonna be tough once we get to the 100-foot line though.
I understand. Well,
so
as
are
close
you saying
as
the ones that are gonna stay in the buffer zone?
Yeah.
Or?
Like between 35-foot and
just
the buffer.
So
you know
we have
what?
An idea of what's staying, what's going.
You see what's going to happen? See, here's the buffer zone line.
Right.
And basically everything within the buffer, between the buffer and the 25 zone of natural vegetation is going to be disturbed.
It's going to go. Okay, well then maybe the 100-foot?
Okay.
Mark the 100-foot line.
100-foot, so we get a sense of where that is in the fields and the, actually just the 100-foot. Or do other people want to see the 35-foot as well?
Well, is it?
You're not cutting anything inboard or in from 25 in to the wetland
other
area.
Than the mitigation area.
Right.
So the 100-foot and the 25?
Right, that's
right.
What I'm thinking.
All right,
so the wetland
so we can really see the area.
So the wetland flags from the original ORAD or ANRAD are still there, right?
We've refreshed them, too.
Okay, so those are there. Put a 100-foot line.
We're going to give you the remaining these two house boxes, the back corners here. We'll give you the 100-foot buffer zone line, the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation line. We have this line staked. We have the street, both sides, a couple of points around the cul-de-sac bulb. We have this edge of driveway. So that should give you
a good idea of where everything is.
Yeah, yeah.
We can take care of the tree mitigation policy by the number of stakes that we have out there.
And
if
for
we
lots,
use live stakes, we could have taken care of that.
You know, for lots 3 and 4, the house stakes don't have to include the little jag in the middle of
right.
The, you know,
I,
just,
I would,
yeah.
I would give you
yeah.
4 corners.
Right.
I just one more question. Those, as you come down the driveway in lot number 2, you have the BMP. Does that BMP flow into the one just at the end of the cul-de-sac and then? And what happens when it fills up? Are these things connected or not?
These BMPs should infiltrate a 100-year storm event, and I don't believe the one on lot 2 is intended to flow to that smaller one by the cul-de-sac.
So they're just isolated,
yeah.
And there's no under drain?
I think why that second smaller one is there is it picks up that lower segment of driveway.
And there's no under drain?
Correct.
So you're going to amend the soil somehow to handle the infill?
It's Merrimack soil, fine sandy loam soil. It's deep, water table is way down.
So what is that going to look like? Is that...
There'll be sort
stone?
Of a subtle, it'll be a grass surface.
Okay.
It'll be a depression in the landscape, but it'll be a grass surface.
Okay.
The homeowners will have to maintain these. There'll be an O&M plant that goes with each lot.
I think the only other question I have is just going forward. A little bit more planting information. Although you said, is there any specific plantings that you think got left out of the wetland restoration area or from any of the BMPs? Or is that all pretty clear, clearly
BMPs,
established?
They're gonna be, actually, the BMPs are going to be seeded with a wet mix, as is the all of the BMPs. And the mitigation area, I just stuck with a wet mix on that. I've done many of these throughout my career. I'm sort of morphing into, I used to put a combination of shrubs and wet mix.
I'm finding that the wet mix is, when it takes off, by the end of the first growing season, it overwhelms the shrubs. And so you have a 3-foot-tall shrub and 5-foot-tall herbaceous vegetation. And so then I started saying, well, get in there once a year and weed whack around the shrubs, but now you're in there trampling the herbaceous stuff that you're trying to grow. So I'm suggesting that we just go with the wet mix and let it naturally progress.
And you wouldn't plant anything on the edges, the more upland edges, as a barrier?
Yeah, it seems like along the southern edge of the cul-de-sac, where you're doing the restoration, if you put some small trees there, it would shade that, keep it a little cooler, a little wetter.
Any other questions from the commission? Any comments from the public? Can you identify yourself?
Crosby, Dustin Road. I have a question and a comment. On those trees there that are on that line, are they allowed to remove the trees on the property lines? Because we own a tree that's like, it grew right on the line and it's huge. So if you take that up, that's our tree.
It's a giant
maple.
We wouldn't be removing any trees off property.
So, but can we have a line of trees that stay? Because there's so many old trees in there.
Can you show us? Can you go up to the map and?
This is our house. That's the giant tree here. It's more like there. But what about trees here? These trees here, for all these people, they just get cut out.
I think they said that all those trees identified are staying.
They're staying.
Is that right, Bill?
Yes, that's correct.
And the second comment talks about a vernal pool. I don't know what it is, but we have frogs all the time in the woods, and you can hear them chorusing. And we try to record it, and the highway noise and Lowell Street just drowned out the recording, so it didn't pick up anything. A couple of years ago, my next-door neighbor passed away, and his pool drained down, and I went over there, and it was full of frogs. So there is something there. It's not that it's not conducive to wildlife or anything. There is something that lives in those woods.
Right. It depends on what kind of species of frogs, and I'm not a vernal pool expert, but you know, you have to hear the chorus of a certain species, or you have to find, you know, the actual egg masses of certain salamanders, or you have to see if there's a food source like fairy shrimp in these during that growing season, and you folks can speak better to the species that you would be that would qualify as a vernal pool.
But does it require that certain weather conditions, because we have early spring, late spring hibernation and all that stuff?
You have to look for them
specifically
that you know, that first real rainy night in April. That's a great time to go out in the middle of the night and look for these things and listen to the chorusing.
Is it only one time of year, or is it all year?
It's only one time of year, because a vernal pool will dry up after the springtime. And the reason that they're so important is that the salamanders lay their eggs in those locations, and they are the, and I think, amphibians that have the fewest eggs. So the reason they're important is there are no fish predators that eat their eggs, and that's why it's so important.
So any other frogs in there, they'll just go away if the trees are taken down?
No, I've seen frogs in puddles. I had a
in pools.
pools and tires. So, you know, the common frogs are a little bit more able to you know, occupy different habitats. It's the breeding time for the salamanders is what the value of a vernal pool.
Another question I might ask, too, is there was discussion before. We have the oldest house in the street. We do not have a wet basement. However, the other side of Dustin Road maintains some pumps, and something the equivalent of a 100-year storm happened, and one of them had 7 sump pumps going, and the fire department was down pumping their basement out. And we don't, do we have a drainage at the end of Dustin Road or not? We just have a stream. We have no drainage anything. down the end of the street. It used to get wet, but not as much. But I just don't want to have to put some pumps in so somebody can have a luxury home.
Right, right.
So.
Which is why there's so much. Do you see the purple squares, purple rectangles? Those are all to take the roof, whatever rain falls on the roof, and put it immediately into the ground. And once it's in the ground, the groundwater should flow towards the wetland.
But there are no trees to evaporate either. The water, it's still going to be in the ground.
Right, right. But if it's flowing towards the wetland, I mean,
even the flat area. They told
us which flat area? What I'm talking about is underneath. Is under.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of the benefit to putting all that clean runoff into the ground is it slows the process down. Because people get the wet basement because the groundwater table rises, right? And it comes up through your basement, and you never, it's like bailing out a boat. You never get to the bottom of it. The solution is to either seal your basement from the outside, which is impossible, because I've considered doing it for my house, or to get an effective drain inside your house so you can really stay on top of whatever seeps in. French drain, or to make sure that the groundwater table doesn't come up so high. And you're right, trees do evapotranspire a lot of water. And you know, the older the tree, the more water it will take up, especially during the summer times. I mean, for this fall, we're at a really historic, pretty marked drought. So all New England-wide groundwater levels are lower than they have been in a long time. So chances of people's basements flooding, you know, in the next upcoming month or two are pretty poor. Mm-hmm. You know, I can't tell you what's going to happen in the spring. That's on the weather.
We have a lot of trees in the neighborhood. People seem to. We had one neighbor who took his entire lot and stripped it right out and put a lawn on it.
Well, planting trees definitely improves people's groundwater tables, and I don't know if many people realize that or know that.
I mean, we have a say when we have people doing, you know, tree removal, limb removal, when it's within our jurisdiction, but when it's beyond our jurisdiction, we can't do anything about that. And that's why we enforce the tree replacement policy. And
Can I just expand on that? The reason why we put these infiltration basins in, these roof water infiltration basins, and that large infiltration detention basin is because we're obligated under the stormwater management regulations of the Wetlands Protection Act to evaluate what the pre-development conditions are, and then you have to mimic that. We realize when you put a road in, you put rooftops in, it takes away areas that were available for percolation. And so we're obligated to approximate the average annual recharge as if nothing happened here. So the bottom line on the stormwater report is that there's actually a half a CFS net decrease of the rate of runoff from the site, which, you know, it's almost immeasurable. But when you run the numbers to the hundredth, this is what you get. But at least we can say it's basically a steady state. And yes, trees will be removed, rooftops will go in, but that's the entire purpose of that basin and all the stormwater biocells on each lot is to mimic the pre-existing conditions.
Thank you, Bill.
Your name?
So, I'm Anna Nolte. I live on 35 Plymouth Road. It's the last house. Both Will Finch and Bill Hex were in my backyard and in Kathy Tierney's backyard, 33 Plymouth Road. Heard the chorusing. Will tried to record it on an iPad. Didn't realize that it wasn't loud enough because I would have been happy to have someone from the tech department at my school to go with microphones if you needed a better recording, but that information was never passed on. every spring, there are chorusing frogs that I hear in my backyard that I am not hearing somewhere else. In fact, if I walk to my blueberry bushes, they stop chorusing because they sense that I'm there. They're right there in the water. Whether they found eggs or not, they're there every spring. And I think one of our concerns is they cut a bunch of trees at the end of Dustin Road, and we had fewer frogs the past 2 years. You go in and you cut all the other trees, you're going into an extremely wet area, you're cutting down all the trees. I have no confidence that if we start to get any water in our basement, anyone's going to do anything about it. We're just stuck with the problem. So I'm confused why we have regulations, why the town has these in place, if anyone who wants a variance gets it. I think as a homeowner, we can speak to people on the street have moved because they couldn't do things to their home because they were told by the commission, the wetlands, we have to preserve the wetlands. So now we're kind of scratching our heads. What has changed? And we've sat through so many hours of conservation meetings. The last meeting that we were at, most of the commission had yet again said, we would like to see a plan with fewer homes. I have yet to come to a meeting where we've seen a plan with fewer homes. I mean, I just feel like they're waiting it out. Now they have a whole new commission. Let's see what we can do. Maybe we can get it through this time. And I think I'm offended that 40B was held over our head.
Yep.
The exact words at the last meeting was, well, I guess we'll just have to go for 40B. And then they submitted a plan for 16 units, which the town, I think the police, the fire, the smart growth plan, everybody wrote letters against it. Nothing came of it. And now we're back again with the same plan.
I think what's worth noting at this point is variance. While the variances, while they're being proposed, nothing's been accepted. We're still reviewing the plans. That we still have to go out, see the site, see what's being proposed. So I personally understand the concern. I think we're still a ways from accepting variances or accepting changes. You know, it doesn't mean that we wouldn't make a decision, but I don't think we're at the point where anybody's accepted what's necessarily being proposed at this time.
Yeah, I think the frustration is from 15 plus hours here in this room.
Mm-hmm. TID 33 Plymouth Road. I know you guys have variances on the conservation end, but they also started going through the Zoning Board of Appeals and had something like 9 different variances. From the size of the street to the no fire truck turnaround, do you guys take that into effect, or they do their thing? That's
we
what
can't
I think
do that.
Doing.
We that's not in our jurisdiction.
Yeah.
That's
so you have no idea how that variance is. Those variances are progressing. So it's 9 for them and 3 for 4 for you, and you know, pretty
we just
soon
feel like
the
lot's too small. It's
right.
Ridiculous.
And yes.
Melissa Russell, 23 Plymouth Road. I just wanted to add a statement. Every meeting, consistently misrepresenting the notion that there's any sort of flooding on Plymouth Road that they plan to remediate. There is no flooding on Plymouth Road. When we have heavy storms, we have a flow of water that swells to accommodate it. I just keep repeating this at every meeting. It's a consistent misrepresentation.
Brian, 27 Plymouth Road. I've brought it up a couple of times. Nobody seems to have an answer for it, but my question is about the snow removal. In one of the plans, it says that the town will not be responsible for that. I don't know if that's still the case, but I've asked multiple times, if you have treated snow, where is that going to go? Will that go into one of these systems? Or is that going to flow downward? You're going to have chemicals. It is a wetland, and there's, as you said, there is a lot of wildlife out there. Not just that, but you're also going to be putting chemicals that are going to be flowing downhill. We're downhill from this project site. Nobody seems to be able to answer that question. Where is that snow going to be piled? It's also going to add to the water table. and nobody seems to be able to answer where.
Do you guys have a plan?
As the street is plowed, you're going up the street, it will be pushed to the side of the road. And as you get to the cul-de-sac, it's going to be pushed in this direction and in this direction here towards the end. It will, when it melts, it will flow on the street and go back through the treatment system.
And that treatment system will remove certain amount of pollutants?
TSS.
Total suspended solids.
And you know that's the best method to remove pollutants.
Can I kind of piggyback on that? Will those trucks, there's also a question in there about whether the snow removal trucks will be able to turn around. Because in the last meetings, it was the fire trucks, and the fire department said absolutely they would not agree with that, that they had to be able to turn that radius to get those trucks there. And I'm just wondering, you have huge plows, are they going to be able to turn there? Because if not, you know what the town, we know, anybody that lives at the end of the street knows what that, the town just dumps it at the end. You know that they're going to come around and they're going to dump it any place that's open there, which is going to be uphill of where we are. And
so the turning radius was increased and it's been approved by the fire department. So that from the last meeting, from a DRT meeting, some of what you have talked about has already been taken care of.
Okay.
The snow removal, I mean, this is designed to handle the snow. And, you know, snow ends up going somewhere on every street, on Plymouth and on Dustin, and it's going to ultimately land into this detention basin and then onto the stream and onto the wetland. But this proposal has improvements to that wetland. And I hear that there's frogs out there, and we really needed some recordings. And it's been several years, and I've talked to people and asked for those recordings. But, you know, it's just not the frogs that we need. So we need egg masses. That's the breeding habitat is what you're protecting. It's not a frog. So that's why it was important to get in there and to start looking. I think that if your real concern is about a potential vernal pool, that with this cleaned up, with the flow going through there a little bit quicker, it's likely to be in a very improved situation where you could get a vernal pool in the future and the frogs could get back in there.
Can I just say, I thought Will Finch and whoever had done the site visit felt that the reason we were hearing it is because it was the uplands in that area were the perfect environment. They'll be gone. I mean, that house right there
but
is where they said was
that
the
was
best
talked about. And the ultimate, you need to get natural heritage approval. So everything you're talking about Bill and Will has been sent up the stream and they denied it.
Twice.
So all that that's been tried. We needed better, new, more, all that.
So the commission has no say over it. You say it's totally up to the state and what the state says.
No, we can. That's why we were talking about a potential vernal pool. The commission can decide, and we have regulations that protect small, isolated wetlands, which are, you know, code for vernal pools up to 500 square feet. So we do have protection, but this commission's been out there. Been, you know, this commission, Anika, myself, about it. But we were out there, we looked, and it was 8 hours, and it was on a Friday, and it was on a Saturday, and it was after a rainstorm, and we looked, and that's when you look, and they weren't there. So this, for me, it's, you know, my hope, obviously, I hope that it was a vernal pool. I mean, then we can really do something about it. But we can't hold them to something that we're hoping for. We have to prove it at some point.
We hold them to regulations that are already in place in terms of not putting a cul-de-sac into the wetland.
That only works in the beginning, so you're saying, so what I think I'm hearing is, you know, we just keep holding them to the fact that there's probably a vernal pool. But I can't do that because
vernal
we've been out there.
Vernal pool or not, there are variances being sought because they're putting structures into areas where there should not be structures.
That's right. And we have a process to go through this. There's a very high standard for a contractor or a developer to get to receive a variance. There's three steps, and there's the one step which most contractors aren't able to overcome is the fact that they need to do a overwhelming public benefit. And when you think about this situation and why they're putting so much money into that stream, and they're taking out the debris and they're opening up the channel, that is a public benefit. I mean,
and
for the entire town, because it's you know, I'm not advocating for this project. I am just explaining what they're doing and the process. The rules are put together, and they when you have people come in here, they're going to look through the rules and they understand them and they use them. We want them to meet our standards. We're not doing anything to prevent someone from building. They need to meet the standards, and if they meet the standards, then you can build. So that's what this process is all about. So they have something, in my opinion, which is a public benefit. So a lot of people come in here and they can't meet that standard as a developer, so they have to stay 35 feet away, but that's all they have to stay away. So we're really only talking a few feet.
Chuck, and just to add, Chuck, there's a lot going on here. There is a lot of benefits proposed. There's a whole bunch of people on this commission that still haven't gone out and seen this site, seen what's being proposed, seen what the current wetland looks like and what the potential benefits are. So I think there's still a lot to be had there for a lot of observations to be had for us to see.
And we'll look at a lot of different variables. So if you think about the particular variances that have been proposed, it's to pave something that's already basically partially paved. It's to put a garage where there's already a driveway, so there's really no impact to water runoff. And, you know, we're calling a retention basin a structure, which, you know, it's not a parking garage. It's a basin to hold water and to help improve the water infiltrating into the soil. So those are some of the reasons why you'd consider a variance here, where you wouldn't if you were going into a completely untouched piece of property. And that's why, and yet we're still going to look for public benefit and offsets to that variance in the form of other remediation. So until we go out and see it, it's really hard to know which way to go.
Okay, I would like to move on. Do I hear a motion to?
I make a motion to continue. This is 270.
We've got more things on our agenda.
Does this have a number?
No.
Okay. 3364 Lowell Street, NOI.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Should we schedule?
Yeah, we need to schedule a site visit. You have one question. I entertain that.
Chuck, if you could scroll a little bit more to the other dotted square at the end of Dustin. I must have misheard, but I thought you said that you owned that square.
Not the square.
Well, I thought that's what you said. You're talking about the square. You said you owned that.
This rectangle.
That rectangle?
Yeah.
Okay.
The square is just an area of highlight on the plan.
You own the little rectangle is part of the stream at the end of 24, doesn't it? Okay. I thought you didn't mean the square. It was
I thought he did, too.
Sorry about that.
Okay.
The other comment I'd like to make that has nothing to do with them is that in this neighborhood, the other thing that we had that had changed was Austin Prep built a stadium and removed trees and for some reason, what wasn't supposed to, and they haven't been replaced, but it's the giant lights and the noise from Austin Prep. So it's not just this one thing. It's been a bunch of stuff for the end of the streets over there.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
For site visits?
Oh, yeah.
We still haven't decided what our...
More staking than I think I can handle.
Yeah.
So...
You're gonna need a survey?
Can you... December 14th.
So currently, our next meeting is December 14th. We're...
At this point, we might have a second meeting in between that time. We gotta decide that. But we would let you know.
That's fine. Might sound good with the staking that needs to be done.
Right.
Are there site visits?
And with Thanksgiving.
And Thanksgiving.
So do we do this Sunday morning or Tuesday?
How about Tuesday?
Why don't we work with Bill?
I would like to try to do it on Tuesday afternoon.
Yeah, I would too.
Yeah.
Unless people can do that. Did that work for you, Harry? It didn't.
Harry, come on.
Sorry.
Hey, would you stay home yesterday? You stayed home today.
Nobody called you today.
We could FaceTime it if you want.
Hey.
Send a drone.
Yeah, should we have drones?
In fact, we shouldn't even have to go out. We should just, the Conservation Commission should have a drone.
Yeah.
Just send it out.
Drones.
That's what those extra fees are for, right?
So Bill, I think we're gonna have to know when the staking's ready and then try to schedule it for between 12 and 2 o'clock on some day.
Yeah.
Thank you all.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I can't make the Tuesday thing a regular thing.
I know.
I can go Sunday mornings, but
Sunday mornings are gonna be hard.
That's the middle of my day in Boston.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's not easy for you to take the train back.
Time change didn't help.
So, no, we don't have anything on the enforcement order, right?
We're waiting for them to record the order of conditions.
Certificate of compliance for 629 Pearl Street.
Certificate. I'm the only one that went out to this site, and
yeah, you had just left.
Chuck, you went out to the site.
I'm trying to get my screen up here. I'm the only one that went out to the site.
Seven streets continued.
Yeah.
Did we do that officially?
We're waiting for them to record the order.
Bill, I hope your ears weren't burning.
Thanks,
you mentioned
Bill.
Your name a couple times in the one before. Have a good evening.
So I went out to this site and I checked it out. The building's been done. It's been one of the slower projects, so the grass did come in, the retaining wall was in place. This is most of the work for the house is outside the 100-foot line, which is right about here. The only question was, and the planting's in, the only question was on the 25-foot line, there's no spot on his own property to put that in. I just wanted to bring it to your attention that there won't be any granite bounds on this site, although the order of condition does say to put one in, but there's not a spot. So I recommend that you approve this certificate of compliance request.
I make a motion to approve 629 Pearl Street.
Second.
Who did that second?
That was Dave. He was a little faster.
All right. All those in favor?
The next certificate of compliance was Artis
senior living, and we had a sizable group of people that got down there on a Tuesday, and there's a mad rush to finish that off. I don't think it's because people are moving in or anything like that. I think that's going to happen first of the year. But it seems to me that there's a lot of things that are conservation related that were forgotten about. And I know we have Hayes being the environmental monitor there, and I was kind of surprised that a fence got installed on the wrong side of the 25-foot line. Some plantings weren't put in. We had debris in our restoration areas and our mitigation areas, like cement and hay bale and berms that would prevent water from flowing in and out. What else did we do? We have concrete bounds on one side of the wetland, but not on the other side of the wetlands. And it's up to the owner to understand his order of conditions, and I get that. But on this site was so big that we had an environmental monitor there too. So
I guess that didn't help.
It has become a problem. So there's a few things we're waiting for this certificate of compliance, and it's really not ready to go yet. Maybe it'll be by the December 14th, but I'm not sure. We're all out there. My list is one of the connective wetlands. There's wetland A and wetland B, and they were supposed to remove the material in between it. So we had some questions about that. And I looked at the plan, and then I looked at the as-built plan, and it seems to me that it wasn't like a foot and a half drop into the pool. It was far less than that. And so Hayes told me that they took that reading off the water level at the time. So now there's not much water in the pond, so that's why it's deeper. It's like a spillway that goes in there.
They took that reading off the water level at the time.
At the time of the existing condition plans was put together.
They're still a half a foot higher than what it says on the existing. It says like 189.6 or 0.3 or something on the plan, and they're at 190.
Those aren't the numbers I remember. I thought it was like 160.
I could be completely wrong with the number.
Yeah, that was like 160 or something like that.
So A and B are the wetlands directly adjacent to Main Street where we started?
Yeah. Yeah, that was where it's
105. At. Not even close. 105.3. I did remember
105,
the point.
And then the other one was right,
106. 107, 106.
106.5, right, 107.
106.8. Yeah. I mean, that's... Not
and then the other thing,
the elevation.
You notice one by the street, it was lower by the street, and then it built up, and that's the grade they met.
Yeah.
And I think that's the whole problem.
Yep.
So I don't know if everyone followed what I was saying, but I think.
Thank you, Anika.
Yeah, sure.
The overall problem is there may be something wrong. I mean, that's supposed to be a wetland restoration, and the elevation might just be too high. So we need someone to make sure that that's going to work out.
Was there a representative from Hayes out there?
No.
The whole time, yeah. Libby Wallace was out there the whole time. She was the environmental monitor.
Work?
And as for backup, it was Bill Bergeron.
For your site walk?
No.
No.
Oh, no, for our site walk, no.
Maybe we should have them meet us out there.
Yeah.
It would be a little embarrassing moment. Might shake them up.
No, we should. I mean, at this point, we've looked and we've identified a problem. They were there, and either Bill or Libby can tell us if that's going to work or not, or what the reason was behind it.
We gave him a punch list of items, and that was included on there.
And I tried to talk to Jim today, but we missed each other twice.
If we go back up, we should request one of them be there.
Chuck, when you mentioned the fence, are you talking about the big fence in the back?
And I know it's moved now, but I wanted to mention it because how does that happen when someone is paying for an environmental monitor to be there? So.
Well, then you've got the grass on the by the pond.
Inside the fence.
Inside the fence, which is inside the bound. Which I get why the fence is the way it is, and it's inside the bound, and that's a compromise, but if we compromise on that, then we at least ought on the other side of the fence have wetland plants instead of sod. Right.
Hey. I think that, you know, you'll get some growth heading up and over, and eventually you won't have a problem.
So they're not going to.
But it's not going to look like a wetland area for a couple of years. Usually
it
takes a long time for
that
sod
the end of the world,
to kind of give up.
Yeah.
In fact, there's some elevations here that are at the end of. Edge of the pond, it says 105.71, and then up past that, the replication area, it says 105.69. It says that area is lower than the edge of this pond, and it's definitely not.
Yeah, we're definitely going to have to, have to go out there, and, you know, I mentioned when this was getting built, I did mention it to him, and that's kind of why I know about that spillway, and they had. An explanation. So, but at that point, let's just see what's going on.
Would that be enough to be a minor plan change, or just we've got an explanation that can change something?
You don't have. Well, we don't need a plan change because they've been approved to do it. So they just have to get it right.
To me, this is just like awesome prep, where they put it a little bit too high, you know,
right.
A little bit
yeah.
too high. Go out there and fix it.
There's yeah.
I wish I brought that, but.
What's up with summer? Who are you enforcing now?
That's been on there for a while, right?
Well, he came in last week. The owner. Did you guys ever contact each other about replacing the tree?
No.
That was the to-do on that one.
All right.
Contact the owner, and he needs to replace a tree.
Right.
Well, we told him to call you.
And the contractor, I never received a phone call.
Did we?
Well, I thought we left it that you guys would make contact.
Need to be direct, not to, you know. I'm just saying, people, you know, you call me, but if not, hey.
Chuck, would you call?
Here are my notes.
Mr. Murata.
Here are my notes.
Thank
now
you.
Now I know.
Here are my notes from Mr. Murata. We asked him to talk with Chuck about how he can meet the standards of the tree replacement policy. Once remediated, we can lift the order.
Talk with Chuck when Chuck reached out to him, or when he reached out to Chuck?
Well, my thought is...
Well, I don't know. You moved it, and she seconded it. He needed to talk to Chuck. Doesn't imply that Chuck calls him so that he can talk to Chuck. Could be inferred. It's not implied.
Action item. Call Summer Street. What about the contractor?
Oh, yeah.
The contractor?
Mr. Costello.
He hasn't come in, has he?
No. I will call him.
So, the owner is taking care of the problem.
Right.
So, you know, it's not, in my opinion, it's probably not right to have to doubly, you know, it'd be nice to make sure he's aware and he knows.
Who are you talking about?
But
Mr. Costello.
Is he the guy from New Hampshire?
Yeah, we're not
no,
going to
the
name.
Guy from New Hampshire was
we're not going to rewrite the rule.
Hey,
we wrote a while
he had
ago.
The crane.
So
yeah.
We have our policy, which is when someone does something, we need to have the owner and the contractor
so
here
we
to talk
have
to.
Policy.
That's the policy.
It's online.
Yeah. Okay.
We have a tree policy, so we're going going after both of them.
That's. But so what's the penalty?
There is no penalty. It was the hope that. You know, he would understand and tell in the future, tell
no,
his clients.
It says both of them are on the hook for the removal. And it's, you know, it's usually put on the owner, which I would almost tell you to take the owner out of it, because the contractor who does, you know, one every day should be on top of the regulations, just like a plumber, electrician, carpenter has to pass a license and understand the rules and regulations. You know, to say, I didn't know, and I'm gonna not come to the meeting. So I don't think that, I think that at least to be able to have an opportunity to tell them what's going on will educate people for the next time. That's my thought. But there's no need to fine or anyone. I mean, you don't have to do that.
Well,
yeah.
Were you using a private email server when you were communicating?
The Dalmatian who caught the fire truck this morning.
Well,
what?
He's the Dalmatian that caught the fire truck.
The
now what's he gonna do?
Morada is proposing to remediate, I guess is my point. And we shouldn't be asking for two remediations.
We weren't going to. Hmm. That wasn't the purpose of having.
Okay, it's just to get him in here.
Okay.
I have a question. What happened to our coconut logs on Main Street?
That happened today?
They were supposed to happen today, but I didn't get a phone call, so maybe it's going to happen tomorrow. So they're kind of ready to go. The stuff is available, so if I can remind the commission, their plan was to finish off the parking area, do the planting around the parking area. I think that you see that's been done.
They were
and
cut
then
those trees.
Now they may be cutting the tree or doing the logs, but he wanted to wait until the stream was lower for the logs. So this is, to me, something that's a kind of a delicate situation. So if the stream is not at a low flow, you know, low flow levels, then if they're waiting, then they're waiting.
So he's moving on that building, and he's going to want to be in compliance for an occupancy permit, right? Oh. Or if the stream isn't low enough until
core logs aren't a condition.
Tell the commission that, and you guys will decide whether you want to allow him to open up his building or not.
I'm surprised the stream isn't low enough.
Yeah, I don't know. He didn't talk to me. I'm just giving some examples. No, and it's definitely not number low. There's more water everywhere. Everything is filling up again. So, yeah. It's, you know.
It was pretty dry about 5 months ago.
Yeah. 5 months ago, they were doing something else.
Yeah.
You know, everybody.
Not what the Conservation Commission wanted them to do.
Why? What was that?
Put the coconut logs in when there's no water in that thing 5 months ago.
They weren't proposing that 5 months ago.
No. This came before us like a month ago, right?
Yeah, not that long ago. 2 months.
And I think it was. I think things were actually filling up at that point too. It'll get done.
Well, you guys are all married. You know what the right answer is. Yes, Al, you're absolutely right.
Al, you got a little chip on your shoulder.
Yo, you're Florida, you should be more relaxed.
Did you run into like a reef or something with your boat?
That guy is aggravating me. He's getting away with something here, and I don't like it because I don't get away with anything.
No, they just.
Oh, with those constructed wetlands, I've done those like 5 times. Christensen designs them everywhere, North Andover.
Is there one that we could go see that would be a good demo for us all to see?
I could get you like 5 or 6 examples. They're much better than just these replication areas.
It seems to be
these big holes in the ground.
That the town seems to me that the town didn't.
George didn't want
every,
it. I proposed one for Bethune, if you'll remember.
Time.
George said no.
Can I ask you guys a question?
Go ahead.
Are we finished business? Because if
yes.
I won't have to take notes if you close the meeting.
What about
and
the
then
gas main?
What
about the gas main? We just saying yes, rubber stamping that.
The gas main was within like the 80 feet, 60 to 80 feet of a wetland in the road right of way. The town has a general permit that allows them to work in the road right of way, but the gas company doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
So when they called me and said, do you want us to come in and file? And I just said, I don't think so. I don't think the commission wants to entertain something that would be an automatic, just go ahead and do it. So I did administrative approval, and they wrote up a narrative, and I sent it out to you. No.
Oh.
So the answer to his question was yes.
They're just going to
They're just going to do it. Well, no, no. They're not just going to do it. It means they just showed up in town and started working. We did several emails.
Get something.
And they wrote something on it, and we got all the information except for someone to come here and tell you.
Yep. Chuck, did you get their BMP guidance? It referenced that they attached a best management practice to this. Please refer to the attached BMP guidance documents for additional details regarding pertaining to BMP placement and installation.
I don't know, but I was satisfied with the plan that shows erosion control and the distance from it. So if you guys want to have me ask them for that, then that's fine. So I was...
You know what erosion control is.
I couldn't get...
As long as somebody drives by to just verify.
Exercise about this if I wanted to. Maybe Mike.
I get excited over it.
Yeah. They actually want to do another thing. I'm actually meeting them down off Walker's Brook Drive to look at that spot. Does anyone know where the natural gas area is there? It's kind of between the Shell station and Keurig. There's like a gate.
Yeah, I do know that.
So they want to do something there, another administrative approval, but I don't know about this area, and I needed them to do a site visit. So I don't know if it's going to be one or not.
I think that's literally a concrete, like an asphalt
platform.
Like surrounded by wetlands.
Mm. Yeah.
Like wetlands are growing up through the asphalt, and there's a building there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I gave him the benefit of the doubt, and I said, meet me out there and show me what you're doing.
Okay.
See what happens.
That's it, right?
That's it.
Okay.
Make a motion to...
We don't have any.
No? Go ahead. You can make a
motion. You are going to write them up.
I wrote them up by hand. I need to type them and submit them, and I will do that for the next meeting. I apologize. I forgot. Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Thank you.
All those in favor.